We are live at the national championship game. Alabama, Clemson, Nick Saban going for history in the desert. Game time coming up.
Film Room is presented by AT&T, mobilizing your world.
And we welcome you back to the Film Room. We were here a couple weeks ago, about a week and a half ago in Dallas. Had a great time. Coach Pinkel joined us today, the head coach at Arkansas, Brett Bielema. Booger McFarland, Greg McElroy back. You've not missed a Film Room. Booger, you haven't either. But you're here for the first time. And thanks so much for being here. And we're looking forward to hearing from you.
Great to be here. I'm excited to hopefully add some insight. I know it's a very exciting environment out there on the field. It was a pretty electric environment out there.
We were just out there, and Booger, you can pick up a lot of different things from the field. What did you take away?
Well, the Clemson faithful are ready to go. I mean, they were in their seats probably 2 hours ago. The Alabama crowd is a late arriving crowd because they've been there and done that. You can tell this game is important to Clemson. I just wonder how the kids in the locker room are feeling. Are they starting to feel the importance? Are they starting to feel the pressure? We know what Nick Saban is saying to his team. I wonder what Dabo is saying to those young guys at Clemson, Greg.
If you got to get woken up for this one.
Yeah, exactly. It's the natty, baby, yeah, the natty.
I tell you, this is, I love this game, being on the field just a little while ago. It is. I mean, it's about 60-40 Clemson, and that's being a little generous towards Alabama.
That's being really generous.
Yeah, I didn't see it when it was all the way full, so I'm just assuming everyone that wasn't showing up yet was Alabama fans. But I will say this. I think that this is not going to matter who's in the stands, who's in the crowd. It's about the guys that go out there, manage the environment, and execute. Coach, you've played in huge games before. What does it take, and what's your message to the team early?
Well, I think it's you got to be the good you. You know, everybody gets so intense and – you know, you're going to have some things happen. Try to preach to the guys. It's not what happens. It's how you react to what happens. There's going to be some things. And it's about that momentum as it flips. Who responds the best? I think the young guys in these games in particular, your seniors, you don't worry about juniors. And as they keep going down, sometimes it's those young guys that really make the thing swing.
Let me reestablish what we're doing, because every time we do this, we get a million calls. Where's the game? Game is on ESPN. There are many choices tonight. This is the best, of course, other than the game. And what we'll do here, we'll watch the game with you, Greg, Boog, Coach. We'll tell you what's going on. And we'll also sprinkle phone calls in. We'll have special guests along the way. And here, the Crimson Tide coming out onto the field in a national championship game, Greg McElroy, 2010, you were doing this. What was going through your mind?
First thing that goes through your mind is pick your knees up. Don't want to trip out of the way of the tunnel. Hey, you guys laugh, but you know what I'm talking about.
I know exactly what
you're
talking
about. That's viral video.
Oh, quickly.
I'm telling you, you know, you got to pick the knees up, make sure you get out, get across the field. Nothing too crazy. You see the smoke flying like this. You can't see in front of your face.
Exactly.
So make sure that you're very aware of what's underneath your feet. But I remember standing right here and on the sideline and looking and taking it all in. And I remember we had never actually been on the field for a game in which we sang the national anthem while on the field. Mm-hmm. Usually that's done by the bands before we went on the field. So there it is. Josh Groban and Flea are playing, and I'm sitting there thinking to myself, oh my goodness, we are here. We're in the national championship game. This is what it's all about. Mm-hmm. And I would assume right now that's about how these players are feeling. I want to kick it off. I want to get going. I want to get started, because we've been talking about this one for 12
Coach
days.
Coach Nick Saban down there, what is going through his mind right now?
Well, he's probably thinking about, all right, we're the visiting team. We're going to win the coin toss.
Heads or tails.
You've already told the guys whether you're going to defer or take the ball. And sometimes that's so monumental, you know. But today with indoor game, obviously minimal effect. But I always think about this. We've always favored to take the ball, because I think if you start off poorly on offense, the thing you're going to do is you're going to punt the ball. You start off bad on defense, you're talking about points. And I think that's a huge thing in these type of games.
You know, and I always went the other way from a defensive perspective, especially if you're a defensive team. Put your defense on the field first, okay? Alabama's a defensive team. What they do on defense sets the tone for their team. If I'm Nick and I win the toss, I want my defense on the field because the biggest matchup of this game, what we all want to see, we're not talking about Clemson's defense against Alabama's offense. We're talking about one thing, the Alabama defense against Deshaun Watson. Give us what we want and figure out what the game plan from Dabo Sweeney is going to be very early. Coach, I know what a veteran quarterback like you had with Brandon Allen, did you script the first couple plays or did you know what you were going to run beforehand?
We did. We had scripted out for sure the first, you know, probably 12 plays. I think our offensive coordinator had a better handle as he got further into the game, but you definitely want to see those first three or four plays. You've been watching them for, now in this case, for a couple weeks. You're excited to see their not just you, your players, all the people that know on the sideline. It's pretty exciting.
One thing that I always liked early in a game, and when I'd visit with McElwain, and I know you guys would visit with Coach Enos, whatever it may be, offensively, I want to have all the different formation variations in the first eight plays, and that's the amount that we scripted. I want to have a spread look. I want to have a pro-style look. I want to have a two tight end look at the line of scrimmage so I can see what Clemson's adjustments might be. I always like to incorporate a lot of different aspects, maybe a screen or two, especially early, because these guys are going to be feeling the emotion of the game, and they're going to be coming out, pinning their ears back, and trying to affect Jake Coker.
One thing we're going to do throughout the night is take phone calls. We'll take one quick one here, and then we'll integrate them later on. Let's go to Phoenix right now. Ron, what's your question?
Yeah, this question's for Greg. I'd like to know if he got to call his own plays.
I don't think Ron's there.
Ron is in Phoenix. He's yelling from the
He actually is.
What's going to happen tonight, Coach? You seem, in our earlier conversation on our show, fairly upbeat on Clemson. Why?
Well, at first, I'm high on Alabama as well, but I realize where I'm at. But I'm excited because I've known Dabo for a number of years. I like just his personality, his demeanor. His players really respond to it. In these big games, I think they're going to be cautiously loose. But, again, I just think Alabama hasn't seen the quarterback they're going to see tonight in his productivity, in the running game, the throwing game. In the SEC, we've had a lot of good quarterbacks, but no one quite even close to what Deshaun Watson's going to bring.
Well, and you know, you talk about Alabama, guys, offensively, they came out last game, the first five plays were passes.
Yeah.
I don't think we're going to see that tonight.
No.
I think they're going to establish the ground game early, settle Jake Coker down. As long as we see the Jake Coker we saw the last seven or eight games, that's the guy that settled into this offense. He understands it. The Jake Coker of the first five games was a guy that was very sporadic, thrown into the double coverage. So I think they're going to lean on the running game, especially early tonight.
We're watching the coin toss, and Mark Ingram looking pretty natty there here at the Natty.
Yeah, the Saints, they didn't do too good this season, Paul.
Golly, Tampa Bay Bucks guy coming in with the NFC South smack. Keep that out of it.
I'm just saying, man, the Saints didn't do too well.
Congratulations on tremendous season by both teams.
Pac-12 crew, Coach, what does that mean?
Well, you know what? It's interesting. You know, in our conference, we had some Pac-12 matchups, but not near as much as any other conference that we went against this fall in the preseason or in the postseason. I think it's a critical point about how they're going to handle the no huddle, how they're going to handle they're going to let them play in the trenches, whether they're going to have holding calls, how well they're going to make sure that on the back end they're getting away with some pushes, maybe on the long balls.
Clemson won the toss, deferred. It looks like Alabama's going to get the ball first from what we're seeing here.
Clemson deferred.
Yep, Bama gets the ball.
That's a good opportunity now. We're going to get a real good early look to see what number two, the cornerback for Clemson, Mackenzie Alexander, has a hamstring. Not sure if he's 100%. How will he match up against Calvin Ridley? That's the expected matchup. And then also number 90,
yeah, Shaq Lawson.
The unanimous All-American defensive end, Shaq Lawson, sprained his MCL. So we'll get a chance to spotlight them early to see if they look like they're 100%.
Coach, Nick's being interviewed right now. How do you feel about it? You're about to play the national championship game.
I've went with it just because I believe when you do get a chance to talk and get your message out there, there's nothing wrong with it. But I think every coach would probably defer to 5 minutes before the game, maybe 15 minutes.
Yeah.
But this
seems
right up before
close.
Kickoff is pretty tight. I was going to say here, the one thing that just jumps in my mind right away, the one blip on the radar for this year, Alabama, Ole Miss, two turnovers off of their kickoff return.
Yeah.
And this is that first unit. I know everybody on that sideline for sure is going to feel that little, okay, are we going to be all right? We're going to be all right. And I know that's going through their heads.
Not that it matters, Coach, but just in terms of who looks more nervous, I'd say Dabo.
Wow.
Eli Gold, the longtime voice of the Alabama Crimson Tide, will take us to the kickoff.
A remarkable record of 104 wins and 18 losses on the field in his 9 years here at Alabama. Dabo Swinney, the 93 graduate of Alabama, is the head coach of Clemson. He is a Pelham, Alabama native in his seventh full season at Clemson. He was an assistant coach at Alabama before coming to Clemson. His wife, Kathleen, their children, Will, Drew, and Clay, all proud Alabamians, but they'd like nothing better than to beat his alma mater here tonight.
Eli, ball security, always important for Alabama. Clemson, 107th in the country in kickoff coverage. Their kicker, Greg Hugel, a lower percentage of his kickoffs going through the end zone. So Alabama has a chance to return the ball here, be secure with the football, get off on the right foot.
The kick will go left to right as you listen. Mullaney is deep to the near side. Kenyon Drake to the far side. Hugel, foot to leather. The championship game is underway. Kenyon Drake from a yard deep coming out to the right side, numbers 10. Finds a hole, 15. Runs up on teammate Hale Hentges and is put down by the Clemson Tigers at the 21-yard line. J.D. Davis on special teams, making the tackle, and Alabama going to work first and 10.
So the game about to begin, Coach. If you're Alabama, what are you going to do right out of the chute?
You know what? I'm going to give it to the big dog.
Yeah.
I think that there's definitely a guy in this game that everybody's waiting to see, and I wouldn't disappoint. I do think you might see a record tonight as far as where number three for Alabama lines up. You're going to line up in a variety of different positions and try to keep Clemson's defense guessing.
Shaq Lawson's on the bottom of the screen on the six right there.
All in there in a tight formation. Comes a nice little play action. It's unbelievable.
A safety valve in the flat there.
And there's number two, Mackenzie Alexander. The two players we were looking forward to seeing whether or not they would be a full go.
Question answered.
Obviously both participating in the first play.
Mackenzie looking pretty good jumping up and down. But
yeah, well, hey, I mean, you come out, little tempo here by Alabama.
Tempo.
East and west. I think anything that brings the big man running sideways is only going to be a benefit for the Clemson unit.
It looked like an illegal formation, so
I don't think they were set in that.
It looked like they were set up top. Are they going to give them an offside?
I really didn't like that play call, Coach, because you talked about Derrick Henry going east and west. The play call by design makes him go east and west. I really don't like a toss sweep for him.
Yeah, it was a toss, and it was obviously, what did they get him for in the neutral zone?
Yeah, I didn't see him. It must not have lined up, and maybe headlined it up across the ball. Yeah,
clear as day. Shaq Lawson.
Clear as day.
I mean, he's a full half yard.
Get a jump, big guy.
I know what
Dabo's saying. He's 100% for the game and 100% over the line.
Yeah, exactly.
A lot of times they'll come up to you as a coach on the sideline and say, hey, you got to back him up, got to back him up. But he's lined up in the neutral
zone. Coach, a bad play for Alabama worked out.
It did. It did. Now you got a second and medium. A really good situation. You're ahead of the chains. I think it's a great situation. You probably get another play action.
There we go. More down here. There we go.
Cut back early. Always fighting for the extra yard.
You know, in studying film and watching Alabama, Derrick Henry makes a lot of yards, guys. Pressing front side, cutting it back to the backside. Look for the cutback play
tempo
to be big tonight as Alabama goes tempo.
And Booger, we couldn't find Derrick in the first half of the Cotton Bowl. Looks like we see him now.
Well, Paul, the first five plays, he didn't touch the football. Now he's touched it two in a row, two in the first three plays. So you got to feel good about establishing your run game against this defense and settle your young quarterback down.
Coach, from a bad play, penalty, Alabama gets first down.
Yeah, I think the big part there, too, is these plays are all scripted. I know Lane's into it right now. He hasn't had any reason to go off his script right now.
Shaq Lawson out of the game early.
Throw it away.
Oh, my.
You look at it, a little bit of a busted play. Receiver on the ground, tried to hit a little smoke route, trying to get a throw behind the line of scrimmage. Seen a lot of that from Jake Coker, especially on first and 10.
First time it's really gone to the sidelines for a call.
Yeah, definitely.
Everything had been all tempo, everything had been scripted. Even though it was third down, they went right away.
something to note, Coach. First and 10, incomplete pass. Normally, you come back second and 10, it's going to be a running play. Usually, try to make it third and manageable. Let's see if they come out with that philosophy.
Henry has 8 yards on 2 carries right so far.
There you go.
And he has 3 carries now.
Coach, this is Clemson's situation. They've been talking about it ever since they drew the card. They want to get him in third and long. They want to put the ball up in the air and see what happens. I would expect to show some pressure and maybe either bail out or go ahead and bring it. This is one they've been all licking their chops for, this first third and long situation.
That was just
What did Lane Kiffin notice on the defensive side to go tempo, Coach?
Well, I think they've been hearing it all along. Alabama struggles with the up-tempo, whether it's true or not. The proof is in the pudding. The teams that have been able to beat them have gone some tempo.
Good protection.
Low underneath.
First and 10.
Nice, really
nice job, especially blocking on the exterior. Mm-hmm. That's really good job right there, because if you watch, and you can see in the program right here, Jake, nothing out there. Take what the defense gives you. But you look, this is actually, looks like they actually have a called
Mulaney
route, because 100%. Mulaney was getting ready to block it. So a good job by Mulaney, who's kind of a jack of all trades for this team. He can do it all.
Well, he's definitely not a vertical route runner.
No, he is not.
They set him up for the run. Again, a little east and west.
The east and west surprises me, Coach.
Yes, very much so.
We saw 2 positives, and they were both downhill. I know we saw 2 negatives, and they're both east and west, so. My guess is he might come back to a little more straight ahead. It's just his game. That big body is there for a reason.
And this right here, you look at the clock ticking down. 11:50, 3 minutes plus in the first drive. You want to make sure that you control the time of possession if you're Alabama.
Kenyon Drake is kind of the... he's kind of the Swiss Army knife for him. He's a guy that they run jet sweeps, they run reverses, they throw screens to. You can line him up at receiver. So if it gets to be third and long in a situation, look for them maybe to throw a little screen to Drake. He's kind of that third down back there. Shaq Lawson back in the game. He's kind of been in and out so far. Hadn't really been a factor.
You see that knee heavily braced. He's a difference maker, that guy. Very long, very disruptive.
What do you see so far from him, Doug?
Not really much explosion. You can tell he's very, very limited. He's been in and out right now. He's dropping him a blitz. Max Protect. Nice. Coker's got all day.
That's one thing that Jake needs to continue to work on. Escape north and south. Occasionally he tries to get outside the pocket. Not much of a reason to right there. Looked as though the Clemson defense was prepared for him to try to escape to his right. Hey, sometimes ending the drive with a kick is a positive play. There's nothing wrong with punting it here. You already flipped the field. Now maybe you can pin Clemson inside their own 5 with maybe the best defense in the country up against them.
Looks like they want to have someone beaten up on number 3 at every play.
Yes.
They're going to line somebody up in his face, play a little robber coverage there. Here you can see a punt safe.
All things considered, Coach, what did you learn from that first series?
Well, I think the scripted plays that we saw at Elaine was there was going to be a little bit of everything. They started off with the east and west run game. They went to north and south, and I think those plays were definitely right off the script. And the big thing on third down, they went tempo. It was a 3rd and 1, but they still went tempo. I
want to take us back to that 3rd down where Jake Coker found Calvin Ridley on the underneath route. This is just a little shoot route. It's essentially a bubble. However, he gets to it from a little different situation. Right there, you're going to see Mulaney actually has leverage, so he's trying to hit the outside shoulder of this defender. See him, Ridley at the bottom right here, release right down the line of scrimmage, invite the pass rush, knowing you're going to get soft coverage, and then lock up on the outside. Now, you didn't get a win by our Darius Stewart against Mackenzie Alexander at the widest. However, Mulaney held his block just long enough to allow Calvin Ridley to get across the formation and then get vertical to slice and dice for about 6 inches more than he needed.
Yep. And, the one thing we talk about is this Clemson defensive line is a defensive line that can get to the quarterback. So far, Jay Coker's had all day.
He did. He brought two linebackers, but they were able to max him up.
Right, max him up. He's had all day back there in the pocket. So if I'm Alabama, I feel good about my quarterback being comfortable right now. It's just about Lane Kiffin dialing up a play to get our Darius Stewart or Calvin really open. And if you're Brett Venables, you got to be concerned right now, because 2 pass plays, the quarterback hasn't been affected at all, Coach.
I think the big thing as we see him settle into his plan here. We know that he doesn't move out of the pocket all that
right.
much. They keep him
right.
back there. You might see now Clemson, okay, first series. Now they might be bringing with some outside pressure, something to try and get somebody in his face.
Kirby
and
Smart
make a
getting
throw.
The defense ready. Sixth straight game against an FBS team. Alabama did not score on the opening drive, Coach.
Well, I think the big thing there was nothing bad happened. You know
right.
what I mean?
you
kind of at some point you're against a really good team. You want other good things to happen, but nothing really bad happened. They got them now pinned inside the 10-yard line. They got less than a 90% chance of scoring when they take the ball over, backed up inside the 10. This is balls in your favor. Hopefully you can make a nice stop and they can put the ball right back.
Paul, relatively speaking, our first drive of the Rose Bowl in 2010, in January of 2010, our punter threw an interception. So
it was a bad start.
It doesn't always need to worry about where you start. It's where you finish. And I agree with Coach. This is a
We judge Alabama on perfection.
Oh, wow.
They didn't score the first drive.
Yeah.
But this is a little more important here, Coach. What are we going to learn from Clemson right out of the chute?
I think this is big to see how fast they're going to get into that second snap. You can see right here he's making a plea to his players. He's got the respect of his teammates. He's a guy that makes everything go. Quick toss sweep.
Misdirection.
Yep. Getting outside. Notice where they're running. They're running on the edge so far. I think it's a mistake to even try to run the ball up the middle against this defense.
He can't get lined up fast enough. Knew this was coming. Again, they were at the line of scrimmage waiting for that official to spot the ball and go. And this is where the Big 12 or the Pac-12, you know, they've never had this team out there. How are they going to get the guys lined up? Look at that official sprint in there. Gets out of the way. They're getting it going as fast as they can.
It's a good throw, actually. First attempt of the game. You got to throw in a comeback to the field from the far hash. Pretty accurate throw right there.
And going tempo for Clemson, notice Deshaun Watson had all day because Alabama can't substitute and get Tim Williams in the game. They can't get their nickel pass rush front. So tempo does a couple of things. It gets the big guys tired, and it doesn't allow Alabama to get their specialty rushers coming off the edge. That
was a good fill right there.
Jonathan Allen making that tackle.
First two snaps, 28 and 29 seconds left on the clock, Coach.
Mm.
Yeah, just take a look at this, man. I mean, if you see Jonathan Allen inside, little read option on him. You got to block him at some point, though.
And really nice fill right there by Matias Smith. Back in pass coverage, but definitely has run responsibility coming up and filling and making the tackle at the line of scrimmage.
Took the play in 200.
Yeah.
Too deep, man. Got it.
That's just a good throw by
very good
Watson.
Throw.
On the run, not much pressure, able to get outside. The left end coming outside. Tim Williams goes underneath, which he breaks container that side. If you're Tim Williams, you got to get upfield and keep Deshaun Watson in the pocket.
It's just a simple thing. Just keep the quarterback.
Yes, keep him in the pocket.
You're going to have, I'm sure they're going to go nuts on the sidelines. They're going to go as fast as they can right here. Second and eight.
What do you see on the line play so far, Coach?
Well, I think Alabama is definitely controlling what they want to. Just a mistake there in the end on the contain. But
yep.
There's definitely nothing going on inside. It's got to be support and how they tackle on the perimeter. You see, give me the call.
You see a spread variation, a reload.
Screen, here they come.
Screen, yeah. And drop.
He's ruling it down, incomplete.
The game plan is very evident early on, Paul. Notice what they've done. Everything that they're running from a running standpoint is on the perimeter. It makes no sense to run between the tackles against Alabama. Clemson's game plan right now is screen, tempo, get the ball outside to the edges. Kirby Smart, Nick Saban will pick up on that at some point.
Alabama was able to substitute there, even though there was
fresh bodies.
Now they got what they want, got a little sub package. The key will be if they convert here, how fast they go on first down.
Yeah, Reggie Ragland now at right end, Tim Williams.
Got a five-man pressure.
A little five-man pressure.
Pretty good throw right there once again, but nice coverage from Cyrus Jones, really shutting it down and not allowing any room on the front side.
We come back. I'm very interested in the health of the two stars for Clemson. I thought they were a little bit dicey in that first possession.
This unit right here, though, Paul, the punt team for Clemson, a bit of a liability. Teasdall, their punter, averaging less than 40 yards a punt, and Cyrus Jones, four punt return touchdowns on the season.
He's a runner.
Very nice return. Alabama plus minus 40, 59 yards to pay dirt.
We're here in the film room again, getting commentary from Coach Brett Bielema, Booger McFarland, and, of course, Greg McElroy. Later, at a later point, we'll take your phone calls at 855-242-7285. Very interesting game so far, guys. But Clemson, we'll be right back with much more coverage.
Feinbaum Film Room is presented by AT&T, mobilizing your world.
Welcome back to the Film Room here on the SEC Network. Paul Feinbaum here in Alabama, about to get the ball for the second time. Brett Bielema, Booger McFarland, and Greg McElroy. Greg, what are we going to see here?
Well, Boog's going to diagnose this third down play. It was an incompletion to the left-hand side by Deshaun Watson, but there was a little bit of pressure on the inside, Boog. Show us what happened.
Yeah, take a look at here. You're going to have a five-man pressure. You're going to have these guys coming here and here, but watch the linebacker also come. And this is very important because when Alabama brings four or less, they're leading the Power Five with 38 sacks. Here they brought five. Very important. They're bringing five against Deshaun Watson.
But also watch the safety, Matias Smith. He's on the championship. Look at him come in there. He's sliding into the middle of the field and occupying this zone. Basically what he's doing right there, and you see Eddie Jackson retracing to the middle, it's called a cover one hole. Man-to-man. However, he's responsible for Deshaun Watson taking off and running.
Basically, we saw a little spying there.
Little spy.
Seeing a lot of Derrick Henry.
That's an old Washington Redskin play out of shotgun. Old counter looked like there, Coach.
It was. Brought the guard back over, gave a little misdirection with the speed motion. It's going to be interesting to see how they kind of adjust as the game goes on to those motions.
Yeah.
Not a lot of push by the offensive line so far.
Yeah, exactly. You're right.
As soon as I say it,
look at that push on the right side.
On cue.
Got a great push.
My goodness.
Really, really good
level. Got a great cut on the linebacker. No doubt in his mind where he was going on that play.
Press the hole, huh?
Yeah, man, press it.
And run away from Shaq Lawson, too.
Wither up in there again.
Oh,
nice
my.
There you go.
Very good cut. Very good cut. That's a touchdown, ladies and gentlemen. My goodness.
Touchdown, Alabama.
They found something on that right side over there.
Well, I tell you what, and all those linebackers were up on their heels. There wasn't any LB flow over the top with the play as it developed. They kind of committed to the holes, and he found the right gap, made one guy miss, and made it happen.
That was a great run right there. But it was the second down, an eight play that really established the line of scrimmage. Mm-hmm. When you see the push that Alabama has and you get Derrick Henry untouched to 6-7 yards, it's going to be very difficult to bring him.
Yeah, but notice what they're doing. It's coming downhill.
Yes.
Coach, we talked about it earlier. That tall sweep to the left and right, you can get rid of that. This big guy wants to come downhill. He wants to put that foot in the ground and get vertical.
I know Alabama made a decision not to let anybody know their grades. But this could be the last time you see him, number two.
Yeah,
and he knows it. Everybody around him knows it. And they're ready to see him play.
Coach, could be. I think it's Derrick Henry's last game.
I personally hope it is.
We'll get a little reaction on that from Alabama's most famous fan, Phyllis from Mulga. What's up, Phyllis?
Hey, Paul, touchdown, Alabama. Let me tell you something, Bama. Look, you've come too far. You have worked for years, and you've missed a couple, and you've won several. But listen, remember, every single day in that locker room and on that field, the blood, sweat, tears, all your family, all the pride of the fans for you, you've got to get out there. Pull it out. Reach down your bootstraps.
You know Phyllis, don't you, Coach?
I've met her a couple times. Don't know her personally.
Pull them up as far.
She's a sweetheart,
Brett. It's an honor to meet.
Hey, Phyllis,
it's an honor.
Phyllis, calm down. The players can't hear you.
We love Phyllis.
Okay. Coach Bielema, it's an honor to meet you. But anyway, Bama, listen, you got it. This is the national touchdown. I mean, the national trophy. This is what Cal Turd said you could never win again. But you can.
He said the dynasty was over.
No, no, no. The dynasty will never be over because this team I'm watching on this TV right
tell us,
now
tell us. Let me give you some advice.
Not going to let it be over. Not now,
Phyllis,
not well, ever. Bama, go do it, buddy.
Phyllis,
you can do it. You're
only
my team.
Okay.
I believe.
Thanks, Phyllis.
Touchdown.
I believe in you, too. But we are going to move on.
We love you, Phyllis.
I mean, it's only 7-0.
Yeah, we love
you, exactly.
Let's not get carried away. A lot of game to play. But let's go back to the second down run.
Yes.
And I want to talk about this. Coach, I know you love this. I love the numbers game right here. You look at the man for a man. I want to count out the blocking schemes. That's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. All right? For Clemson, you're looking at 5 defenders. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You see man for man on the outside with the wide receiver. And look at the push along the right-hand side. Nice wander. Look at the double team. Getting up to the second level. Forcing the line of scrimmage to be reestablished 3.5 yards downfield. That was great. You see the push. Mm. That's what they're going to have to contend with every single time. And then we'll get back here and see the third and one touchdown. I mean, it's clockwork. But.
And here's a person I want you to watch. Watch O.J. Howard. O.J. Howard, to me, delivers one of the better blocks that we've seen. And we don't talk about him a lot, especially in the pass game. But watch the block that he makes on this touchdown run.
And watch the cutback, too. Look at the cutback.
Exactly.
Look at the cutback right there. Look at the green grass. Mm-hmm. There's nothing open. There's nothing there. It's Booger, all she wrote.
We didn't see Derrick Henry a week and a half ago. He's already had 71 yards on 7 carries.
Man. Paul, I told you, he's going to carry it 30 times
tonight. 50 on 1, though. 50 on 1. He's going to carry it 40 times, at least, I'm telling you.
Let me just forecast. I bet you for the very short near fashion, Clemson will have at least one man in the middle of the field on every play from this point forward. You're not going to leave the middle of the field open against these guys with that kind of potential.
And a really nice run back right
there. Very nice.
Octavius Scott there. Yeah.
I'm telling you, I think in big games, that's one of the most important groups you can possibly have, the kick return game, because it's after a score or it's starting a half. You have to, no matter what, try to relieve some of the momentum that the team just had, or at least gain some as you start the second half or the game. So a nice job right there. And a good job by Adam Griffith. Not a good kick, though. Not a lot of hang time. He's a guy that has 52 touchbacks this year.
Yeah. He just got in the way. All he did was get in the way.
Hey, that's all you got to do.
You want the definition of it's not what happens, how you react to what happens? You get a great return like that, and you can answer it right back. Nice little 6-yard pickup. You're ahead of the chains.
Back on track.
It was zone coverage. Okay, zone coverage, wide side of the field trips. Nice little turnaround, sit-down route there. Easy throw, easy catch. Get your quarterback some completions. The first couple of throws, Coach, were way outside, long developing throws. Route. Yeah.
A little 323 double stick, bud. Come on.
Yeah, okay.
That's what you called it, right?
Every day.
Nice little inside. Stood it up.
Yeah, and you see.
Third and five.
See, to me, that's a throwaway play, Coach. I mean, I know you guys are a physical running team, so you guys pride yourself running the ball inside. You just can't move A'shaun Robinson. Just look at that.
No, you got to have more bodies. There's no one to protect. You got one more than they did.
Coach, how big is this play?
This is big here. I think you want to try to do something that makes him move, gets him on a perimeter. Alabama's got
sprint,
six up.
Sprint right or something.
Something.
Alabama's bringing pressure.
Ooh. He wants it. He got it. He willed his way into that one. See here, now this is a difference in Cruz as well. Are they going to let him play handsy? Clemson was trying to run underneath the linebacker or the safety, grabbed him around the hips right there, delayed his ability to react to that football, and now we got a penalty.
It's the correct call. I mean, you had a little bit of a mesh, and that's tough on a defense.
Yeah.
With Alabama running as much man-to-man as
he's going to hip him right here. He's going to hip him right there.
Yeah.
Can't do it. They're going
to call.
Great call by the back judge. Great awareness. It's exactly where his eyes should be.
It's the correct call.
You know, Coach, Alabama blitzed the fewest times among the Power 5 conference teams. They're bringing pressure early. What does that tell you about the game plan?
Yeah, they're going to try to make him make bad decisions. I think they're going to try to dictate his decision-making. Yeah. Obviously, playing 4 here, scramble up the middle.
Deshaun's first carry, mind you. This is a guy that against North Carolina and against Oklahoma carried it 24 times in each one of those two games, and 21 times against South Carolina in the final game of the regular season. I don't think they want him taking the abuse that the Alabama team might be able to give him by running him a lot on the quarterback design runs.
But one thing, they might want to get him tired a little bit first.
Maybe so.
Zone read.
Back to a third and four.
Coach, you're looking at plus territory. Their field goal kicker, Clemson, not great from distance. What are you thinking four down territory here? Do you run?
It could be
run
a long way down. You know, you're under 34.
Sure.
You're looking at, you know, a 51-yard field goal. You don't want to really put yourself up in a bad situation for a block or a low kick. Could be possible two down for these guys.
Good point, Coach. Sprint.
There's your sprint. Here's out the move, right
there. Yeah. Oh, now contain. This is the thing that he can do that nobody else can do. You know, we have guys all over in our league, but very few of them can do that right there.
But if you, Greg, can you run that back a little bit? Once again, an Alabama defender on the outside loses contain, and that's something that if you're Kirby and Nick, it's got to bother you about your outside defenders losing contain. We'll come back to that in a moment.
Yeah, I think they might hear about it. Now, there was perfect contain to the field, though.
Correct, correct. Pulled him up.
Shot.
Oh, he got him.
Nice throw.
And I'm sure we won't hear from Phyllis.
Yeah, I was just looking down to see if she'd call back.
And that's something that he has done such a good job of this year, throwing the ball down the field, particularly to the right side, outside mm-hmm. the numbers. That's his 10th touchdown against zero interceptions down the right sideline. And down the left sideline, two touchdowns against two interceptions. Throws a very good deep ball to the right.
We'll take a break. Game is tied in the first quarter.
That ball was money right there.
Very good throw.
Back in the Feinbaum film room, we are an alternative to the ESPN broadcast. Coach Bielema, Booger, and Greg McElroy. Let's grab a call here. Benjamin in Georgia, go right ahead. Benjamin, you there?
Now that you've seen both teams' offense and defensive line, and I know you're great at with your offensive line and whatnot, what do you think, which team is doing better on both sides of the ball with their power levels and their power angles and their pad level?
Well, I think that second drive by Alabama, for sure, when they're coming downhill, those linemen know it. They enjoy it. They were knocking them off the ball, cut off some pursuit angles, and then he let Mr. Henry take over. Clemson had success because, really, Alabama did everything right, but they're able to make a nice throw off the play, you know, just getting a great throw by their quarterback. Big-time players playing big games.
Davis is in Georgia. Go right ahead, Davis.
Yeah, I had a question for Coach Bielema. I just wanted to ask him. He threw out those two stats earlier about, and the second one about Watson, and I was just curious where Watson's production really can separate itself from, say, like Chad Kelly, who put up very similar numbers to the season.
Well, I think it's going to be the four-quarter effect. I believe he's only carried the ball one time so far in these first two series, but you know, there's only three quarterbacks in NCAA history who have thrown for 3,500 and rushed for over 1,000, and we're looking at one of them right here, and the other one was a guy by the name of Johnny Manziel, who was also a little bit of a problem for Alabama that day. So, you know, it's a formula for success.
And you see a nice return there. We talked already about the importance of having a really nice return. And this is the play right here, just a little hook wheel.
Eddie Jackson, yeah, what is he
he's
doing?
He's late getting off the hash. I know there's play action. He has run responsibility. However, a poor angle, and he didn't get over the top of the deepest receiver. Misplayed, but, you know, that's what Deshaun Watson's capable of. Not every quarterback in the country can make that throw consistently. I know your guy could do it, Coach.
Well, you know, I think even just seeing Dabble, that is something they saw in film. They got the coverage they wanted, the look that they wanted. Dabble started accelerating and down the field before the ball was even thrown. So he knew that was the play they wanted.
Jake Coker just 3 for 5 for 9 yards so far. So nothing really over the top.
Yeah, but you got that big bull. That's 7 yards right there downhill.
And I think they can do that more often than not.
Yeah. And you know what that's going to do? That's going to set the play action up. And, Coach, you talked about them not having the middle of the field open. But even if you have one guy back there, you're going to get man-to-man on the outside with Ridley or Adarius Stewart. That's what Derrick Henry does. Alabama throws body blows all game long in hopes in the fourth quarter they can knock you out.
We always say don't get bored. Just keep doing it and doing it and doing it. Here it comes again. A little bit of dance, but don't think that we shouldn't do it again.
Alphonse Taylor right there, the right guard. Losing in the backfield. to DJ Reader, who's the biggest defensive lineman, number 48. You can see him right there. He's the biggest defensive lineman for Clemson. He's a big body, 325. He moves pretty well. I'm no offensive lineman, but I think he was a little high, Coach.
Third and three, interesting.
Nice play, O.J. Howard.
Very nice. Block down the field. I'll tell you what,
man. I bet you they go tempo here.
I mean this. I don't know if there's a guy on that team that has done as much.
Getting lined up,
without
ready to
getting,
go.
Yeah, look at how they're
getting set up. Clemson's walking into it. This is one of those moments where they like to get another one hit right away.
Yep. That just can't happen right there.
Greg, what's going on with Jay Coker?
That can't happen. Indecisive in the run game. You just had a big play. Momentum is on your side. You had a nice third down conversion. You're getting to the top area of the red zone. You have to decide whether or not you're going to run it or throw it. Right there, it's as if he wanted to throw it. However, he almost handed it. So poor decision right there from Jay Coker. Now you look in the second and long. Probable screen down for Alabama.
Screen or draw, you're right. Yeah, screen or draw.
You know what's interesting there, though? You're setting your quarterback up. His first throw wasn't there. He didn't have any other option.
Right.
It was a sack. It was either throw it or get sacked. Obviously, he could have thrown it away.
A little indecision there.
Just discombobulated coming out of the huddle.
So, you know, Coach, it's one of the things I've always thought was a very, very tough decision. Second and 16, everyone says lay back, play coverage, allow them to throw the football in front and rally up and make the tackle, or do you blitz and get the ball out of the quarterback's hands?
Well, I'm thinking this. I think the offense coordinator wants to get half of it back. He wants to get it manageable. So I think you're going to look at possibility of a short pass, but also a run play here to try and get it to a third and eight manageable.
Bobby, you're next. Go right ahead. You're in Tennessee. Welcome to the film room.
Hey, thank you for the allowance. Hey, I got a question about team speed. Is it just me, or is both sides of the ball? Clemson's team speed looks much more than Alabama can handle if Clemson are realizing and keep getting to the edge on the offense.
What about it, Coach?
I think they're both pretty fast.
I think they both got skilled players.
Just like that touchdown ball there that outran the Alabama safety. You got really fast players all over the field. Here's going up top.
Just a little bit too much mustard on it right there.
Well, and he threw it 5 yards out of bounds. I mean, that's something you just can't do. Give your guy a chance to make a play if you're Jay Coker.
Another thing I don't like right here, you're right on the cusp of field goal range. I like taking a shot, but I don't like doing it at this point because now you're looking at if you don't convert or gain any yards here, you're looking at a 53-yard field goal. Now, that's within Adam Griffith's range, but at some point you have to recognize where you are on the field. Mm-hmm. Stealing some yards to set up a manageable third down is more important than taking the big shot on second.
Interesting. They're almost playing for the field goal there. Yeah, 27. You're looking at about a 44-yard field goal here. Interesting play call there, Coach.
It was, but, you know, I think they have a lot of confidence in their kicker right now. I think that's been evident. Ever since the whole year that when we were scouting him, this guy's made a lot of kicks for him. Feel good about him where he's at.
Only missed two since hitting a 55-yarder before half against LSU. So he's been pretty dialed in since that moment.
Clemson is sort of a safe look here.
Yeah, they're just going to really a three-man rush over the guard.
Not even close.
Wow.
He jinxed it.
Not even close.
And that goes back to the second down play. You know, understand that, look, a second and 16 is not an ideal situation. You just had a tough play after making a poor decision, and I think you make an additional poor decision by trying to throw the deep ball right there.
Interesting stat, guys. In Alabama's last 10 losses, there's something like 10 for 23 on field goals in their last 10 losses. And, you know, the kicking game, turnover, something that will – really inhibit you from winning.
Going to give us a ring. It's 855-242-7285. We're taking a look at Clemson again here, Coach.
A little empty. Letting the quarterback do his work, then he might just take off. There he goes. I tell you what, that's pretty hard to stop right there, man.
That's 11 yards. That looked easy.
You got a four-man rush. You got seven guys covering. They're all covering. All of a sudden, he takes off, picks up an easy 10. Never gets touched.
And the guy that's spying him, Reuben Foster, actually dropped back 10, 11, 12 yards, and he just didn't have the makeup speed to get downhill. He's got to be more understanding of how quick Deshaun Watson is.
Oh, he's got to pull up. I tell you what you find here, too. There's not a lot of missed tackles. Two very good defenses for a reason. They're number one, number two for a reason. Every tackle they make is sound, secure, wraps up, very well coached.
Something you can feel, though, guys. I can just feel it. Clemson, offensively, as a team, they're gaining confidence. Notice the tempo starting to pick up. Second and four, 6 yards, 11 yards. They're starting to gain confidence with their offensive play calling.
Very interesting that they allowed them to do that right there. That's a decision that the white hat makes and allowed Alabama to get a good substitution.
Looks like Minka's coming. Minka Fitzpatrick on the blitz.
All day.
Nice throw.
You got it in. You got one down. Yep.
Sharon Peak on the sideline, the senior.
I want to take a look at that and just see if that foot did come down in bounds.
Coach, let's talk about the defense. Let's talk about Alabama's defense here. What are you seeing in the back in the back end of that?
Well, I see they're making challenges on the plays, but Clemson's been able to get their hands on plays. Here's a double hit.
And one thing I'm noticing so far, Alabama doesn't necessarily have the same pass rush that we've seen.
Yes.
A couple opportunities for Deshaun Watson to escape and make throws down the field. They're quick hitting play.
You know what I was thinking? They're not secure on the edges. They've had two guys take inside moves and allowed the outside to be free for a quarterback that can make it happen. Quarterback draw.
Design run.
Run.
It'll be very interesting how many design runs that he has. He's averaged 20 design runs over the last four games, he being Deshaun Watson. How much time are they going to run him inside against this Alabama defense?
There's just a little kick play, a little quarterback counter to the weak side or a power to the weak side, however you want to phrase it. But
another empty set. Alabama's only rushing four.
Oh. Just a bit outside. That's his quarterback. That was one of the jokes we had all the time.
Yeah, exactly.
Hey, even Heisman contenders miss one every once in a while.
Big call here. What are you going with, Coach?
You know what? I like spreading them out and maybe getting an empty set again.
Quarterback draw, maybe?
I like quarterback draw.
Yeah.
You see right here, you see a little.
I let him have a shot.
Tight alignment.
End zone. Yep. Thought they might give him a chance, you know. They got an easy field goal. Don't try to do anything.
It's a nice throw.
Got a little bit of it. Looked like the number one receiver came all the way to the inside. Might have done some out routes on the inside receiver and got a little middle break.
Yeah, working on Minka Fitzpatrick there.
Minka biting on the
penalty on Alabama turns the clock. Then you have a missed field goal and momentum has changed.
That pendulum swings fast, man. And I tell you what, they took advantage of it. You know, their fans feel it. The whole place starts rocking. Like you guys said, the numbers in that stadium just got amplified by 1,000.
After this kick, we'll take a look at that touchdown play. It's a good throw. Deshaun Watson's off to a good start. Alabama's going to have to get him out of rhythm.
Well, and the thing Alabama's going to have to do is Nick, who loves to coach the secondary, he's got to get his secondary together.
Clemson comes from behind, up 14-7. We'll come back to the film room and your phone calls. More commentary from the coach when we return.
Welcome back to Feinbaum Film Room, presented by AT&T.
Welcome back to the film room. First time Alabama's allowed someone to score more than 7 points in the first quarter of this season. D'Amico Ryans, the great linebacker with the Eagles, formerly of Alabama, is on the sidelines. We'll see if we can hear him. D'Amico, what's going on?
Hey, Paul, how you doing?
What's your impression so far from down there?
Right now, it's not going good. Watson on the outside. So he's doing a good job at coverage, but he has the ability to hold the ball. He can hold the guys up front. You have to sustain the quarterback like this. So we're going to have to find a way to keep it in the pocket.
Okay. D'Amico, we're having a little bit of difficulty hearing you, but thanks. We'll try to hook back up again. Your reaction, Coach?
Well, I think, you know, that Clemson has a plan. They went to it right down there. They're really in a medium to hide red zone for down there. They went a little set route for a 13. He knew that he was getting that safety to turn his shoulders. He just drifted in nicely behind him. Perfectly executed timing in the throw game and catch.
Would love to see what the third down conversions look like for Clemson right now. Had a couple drives kept alive by a scramble to the right. Nice throw by Deshaun Watson. Obviously, you see the little stick nod right there to Renfro for the touchdown.
Great
another
route.
Third down conversion. You had the penalty that gave them a free set of downs. You had the sprint right. Deshaun Watson escaped back out to the left for a free set of downs.
You know, really, unfortunately,
situational defense.
Alabama's had some unforced errors. You know, guys getting their hat in the wrong place on the pass rush. Obviously, the third down penalty was critical. Those things are just they're things that throw you out of rhythm and give the advantage to the offense, obviously.
Alabama needs to just keep grinding the football. If I'm Jay Coker, I'm thinking to myself, okay, I got the best running back in the country. With all due respect, Coach.
Absolutely. No.
The best running back in the – I know Alex Collins is a great one.
I think they won't either. Nick's so great at this. Yeah. They're not going to freak out here.
No.
Let's get some reaction. Mike, what are your thoughts in Alabama? Mike, go right ahead.
Well, yeah, man, I think it's – here we are, year two now, Lane Kiffin's offense. They are a slow-running team, Booger, and your buddy over there, you know you played Alabama football. We got beat against Ohio State with this nonsense of offensive coordinator. Now we open up the game, and we're up-tempo. Why
hey,
would
Mike,
you go
slow down.
Up-tempo?
They just had a big play. Thanks for the call.
Listen,
fans. Okay, well, we'll get the coach to explain that.
Well, you know, I understand the complaints of the first quarter, but stay the course. It's a four-quarter game,
Coach,
for a reason.
In Alabama, they fire coordinators after quarters.
I can tell you why they're going tempo, because right now Lane Kiffin wants to throw a little bit of a wrinkle at them. They haven't seen a ton of tempo out of Alabama this year, and at times they have employed the look back to the sideline to make sure you have the perfect play. Going up tempo at the line of scrimmage gives you enough time to do that. So
nice
I think
movement,
that's
right?
A reason why they're doing it.
Yeah, nice movement by the defensive end. You saw the zone going right. The defensive end slanted inside. They're supposed to make a call where the guy that's coming, the right guard or right tackle, takes him over. Bad communication by the Alabama offensive line on the right side.
Here's your adjustment right here.
Something
the up-tempo at the line of scrimmage allows you to do this.
You saw something.
It's a good pass right there.
Of course, not to put this game into overhype, but how big is this play coming up? And the way the momentum seems to have shifted.
This is a third and long again. So, second and long makes a third and long. This is exactly where Clemson wants to be from a defensive game plan standpoint. You've really taken the ability for a run out of it here. Now you just got to line up and play Coker's eyes.
Alphonse Taylor's having a tough day so far.
Yeah.
Two really poor blocks that led to negative plays. Mm. One right there on the sack, obviously. He's got to get out of the stance and make sure he cuts off the wide edge rush from the defender. Dodd's a good player, though.
He is. Good, very good player.
And there's the same play that they tried to go to a little earlier. A nice play by Mackenzie Alexander rallying up. He beat him the first time, and Darius Stewart's having a hard time locking up with Mackenzie Alexander when it comes to the
rush. I think that hamstring feels pretty good.
The injured guy's looking pretty good right now.
Yeah.
Wish I had my hamstring felt that better.
Coach, when you see a momentum shift like that and you're sitting over there as Nick Saban, what are you thinking about? How do you find it back?
I think for me, but obviously Nick's won a lot more, make sure you're on the sideline, we stay calm here.
Mm-hmm.
You're a really good team. You're here for a reason. Obviously, they've scored two straight touchdowns after you had the opening score. Let's play a great defensive series here. Let's get a stop. Let's get out. Let's make something happen before the half.
Yeah, it's going to be important. You know, Clemson scored 14 unanswered, guys. They found something with their offense. They found something with the up-tempo. They found something with the interior passing game. Football is a game of adjustments. They made an adjustment. So what adjustment is Nick Saban and Kirby Smart going to make?
Well, I think that they're two of the best in the business for a reason. It's behind the 20. You got the ball starting on the 18-yard line. Your percentage of score is so much in your favor now defensively. Don't put yourself at risk.
Alabama's had a third and 16 and a third and 18 in the last two series.
Yeah, both set up by negative plays on second down. A sack, and then obviously after the big long play, you tried to throw a deep ball on second and 18. which I think is a poor decision, especially when you're dealing with the possibility of a field goal.
Let's go to Paul in Seattle right now. Paul, welcome to the film room. Good evening.
Good evening. Love the format, gentlemen. Guys, which SEC team's the most like Clemson in your mind? Born in Fayetteville. Get us there next year, Coach. Woo pig.
Thanks,
for me,
Paul.
It's Tennessee, yes. Especially yes. offensive with the misdirection, a lot of the jet sweeps. You have a big back. Gallman's a big back. Hurd for Tennessee's a big mm-hmm. back.
And you remember Tennessee gave Alabama all they wanted for
they
about did. Three quarters.
Yeah, they were leading the fourth quarter.
Yeah, it was one of those games. I think it's interesting. We just saw that consecutive big time plays by Clemson. The quarterback was outside the tackle on every one of them.
Yeah,
he looks so comfortable right now.
What is this? I mean. Coach, you're just, I know we're talking in panic mode, but Alabama had a lead. They were in good shape. They had a stop penalty, missed field goal. A lot of bad things happening.
There was. And this is how you can be corrected just like that. One third down stop and make something happen.
Something we don't often see, which is Nick Saban talk to his offense. And you can tell he ran over there just now to get a message to his offense. Normally he talks to the defense coach. I think he's trying to right tell those guys, yeah, calm settle down. Down. Yeah, calm down.
Do what you do. You're going to be all right.
All right. What you need to do, you need to win at the line of scrimmage. Right now, Alabama's not winning at the line of scrimmage. Just the facts of the matter. The defense is not able to rush the passer. They haven't affected Deshaun Watson at this point.
Well, they don't have the pass rushers in the game right now. They have guys
right
like Denzel Duvall. They got to get
third
Tim
down,
Williams.
They do.
Okay.
Third down, they're getting their guys in there, and he's still able to break contain on a couple of occasions.
Why isn't Alabama getting more pressure, Booger?
Well, I think what you're seeing is a couple of times they've lost contain. Okay, contain is just about discipline football. Your ends get upfield. Anytime Deshaun Watson can get outside the pocket, his vision becomes a lot clearer. He can see the field more. So if I'm Alabama, I'm telling Tim Williams, I'm telling Reggie Ragland, whoever's rushing, go upfield and then come back underneath. Stop allowing this guy to get outside. Right now he feels comfortable, Coach.
I believe this is the third time on the first play of the game we've seen an empty set out of the gate. They want to see what Alabama is lined up like, move some guys around.
Design quarterback run.
I believe only our third design quarterback run, right?
Yeah, third, yeah.
You know, and they're just letting
design,
it. My guess is that number is going to increase as the game goes on after it gets these big boys worn down a little bit.
Right now, Clemson's 3-for-4 Jeez. On third down. They're feeling pretty good about that.
Just great body language. Kids get the call, turn around, they get executed. Nobody's rattled. You're in a second and third. This is a winnable down.
Oh,
we got a momentum changer.
Really nice play. Little bit too much line drive.
Just one play.
Eddie Jackson.
One play.
Okay.
Same guy that we were getting on earlier about not being a little bit late.
Very, very similar concept. Little wheel concept. The two inside guys pick. The outside guy wheels. Eddie Jackson stays back this time. Earlier, remember on the touchdown, Coach, he didn't get back. This time he gets back. Great athletic play.
Yeah, and you can see right here, they're trying to get a little bit of a little run through and turn up the field. He was a little late earlier on the wheel route, but look at him. Look at him diagnose it right here. He's recognizing it. He's reading eyes. He's recognizing coverage. He's seeing the mesh. He's trying to be alert for who's going over the top.
And notice these two guys right here. They're kind of picking. This is really a one-on-one route between that guy and that guy.
Oh,
boy. And you can see right here. And honestly, Deshaun Watson has it if he throws it with air over the top.
Yeah.
But that's the thing that Alabama is so, so difficult
to do. Greg, what's Lane going to do next?
Usually in this situation, if they were on the other side of the 50-yard line, first and 10, he's taking a shot. He feels as though he has momentum. Right here, you see a little bit of a trickeration play. It wouldn't surprise me right here, second and short, even though they're struggling on third down, to run it and try to get it up inside. There you go.
Once again, the big bull face mask.
Face mask.
15-yard face mask.
Coach, and how things change.
That's all we said.
Big Mo, baby. Big Mo will switch anytime, Coach.
We were lining up pallbearers a minute ago.
Well, a couple of people
on the phone. Unintended, I can idea it, Paul. All right. But honestly, that's the thing. I mean, Alabama, they just grind on you. And honestly, guys, Clemson, when they take care of the football under Dabo Swinney, 42-4 when they win the turnover margin. Alabama, since the Ole Miss loss, plus 12 now after this interception. So.
Great block by Cam Robinson.
Yeah. Really
sophomore
good.
Tackle from Monroe, Louisiana.
You got to throw the Louisiana in there. I love it.
I mean, he's from Monroe, Louisiana.
That's,
big boy.
That's your spot.
Monroe.
Monroe. You know about Monroe, Louisiana,
I
Coach.
I think it's just awesome to see Nick go over. You see him on the sideline. Calm down.
Yeah.
Calm down. Look at his players. Just great presence.
Number two, ready for the ball.
Just keep running the rock.
Change the formation.
Yeah, they've really done a lot of over, you know. Everything is here to the field. They've got a lot of stuff going back.
Unbalanced.
Look for the cutback, too.
They should have called timeout right there. The clock was running down.
They did.
No, they did. Yeah. They did.
Yeah, he got it.
It's a Pac-12 crew. You got to be careful.
Greg, what are you seeing in Jake Coker? He just doesn't seem very comfortable, does he?
You know, just a little bit out of rhythm. Hasn't really had many opportunities to throw it down the field. But I think he needs to recognize that the opportunities are going to come. You're going to win this game by controlling the line of scrimmage. You might have to hit a big play here and there, and he did so by hitting Mullaney on the drive before last. That was a nice throw to get back on track. But
we're going to take you to break as Alabama trying to even the score here in the national championship game.
Welcome back to Feinbaum Film Room. Presented by AT&T.
Welcome back to the Film Room. Coach Brett Bielema, Booger McFarland, Greg McElroy, and your phone calls. Getting a lot of interesting calls at 855-242-7285. Coach, pick it up.
Well, I really like the fact that they came out after the score, went a little reverse. Didn't hit a huge one, but gained 8 yards. Got their players fired up. Had a huge hit from their old lineman. All of a sudden, they're coming off the ball a little bit more zip. This is where Lane would like to keep you off balance. Although they've been going a little tempo, if he gets you on the far hash away from your sideline and you can't sub in time, he likes to pick it up.
It's a great observation. I love it. I love the substitution game. It's so cat and mouse. And this is it. They are far, obviously, deep in their own zone. It'd be tough to substitute from this distance.
I tell you what, just a great call by the quarterback to get a timeout there and avoid the 5 yard penalty.
Yeah, look for the run.
Run left here.
Yeah, cut back. Guys, if you notice one thing, a subtle tendency about Derrick Henry, he loves to cut the football back.
Yeah, he does.
So he'll press it front side, and he loves to cut it back. And some of those are designed, and some of those are just him and his vision, how he sees the play developing. But that's definitely his favorite run play. Hey, here's Monroe, Louisiana, Cam Robinson.
I love it. I think you still have to continue to stay on the ground right now. You've had three consecutive runs that were all successful. Continue to pound it up and inside.
I think you're doing it.
Fullbacks.
46 come back there for a reason.
A little spider two, why banana?
Yep. Oh. I think we've heard that a time or two from John Gruden.
Once or twice. Spider two, why banana? Try to sneak the fullback out into the flat.
You know, almost the exact same situation here for Coker because Clemson had a 3rd and 8 from the 11-yard line. What are you going to do now here? I'll bet you they go in the end zone because they got a chip shot field goal. Make sure you can get it in there and see what you can make happen.
And that was a good throw by Jake Coker. It was behind him. However, that was a zone defense.
He's got to sit down. He's got to sit down in zone.
As he sneaks across the formation, he has to sit down in the vacated zone.
Yep. Got to sit down. That's on the wide receiver more than the quarterback. A little empty. Screen. Make a guy miss.
Really, really
nice.
First down.
Well done.
First down.
Really,
love the play. Love the play design. Motion to the field. Throw the screen backside, get Cam Robinson out blocking.
And when they ran that play last week, what'd they do? They threw the swing route to the right-hand side. Setting plays up. Lane Kiffin's always thinking ahead.
Tempo.
Run it.
Tempo.
To Drake.
Right now, I bet you're screaming.
Where's number two?
Tempo.
No, get number two in the game.
What are you picking up on Shaq Lawson?
Here comes number two.
Shaq Lawson hasn't really been effective. I mean, where he can hurt you, Paul, is in the pass game. In the run game with that knee, he's not going to be affected. That's why Cam Robinson right now, you see where they're going. They're running to the right, cutting back at Shaq Lawson.
Same thing, two more plays in a row. Just line up and do it again. Same exact thing.
You saw Lane Kiffin a second ago,
actually, split
in the single box.
Huge split.
Yeah, that's stealing right there.
Lane Kiffin with a subtle fist bump.
Let's run that last play back, Greg, the touchdown play. Oh, right there from the end zone angle. Oh, Coach, I love this. Yeah, when I say I love this, Coach, they got the two defensive tackles in the backfield, Coach. Two defensive tackles in the backfield.
Quit petition to go on offense. I know what you're doing right now. I know what you're doing.
But let's take a look here. First of all, you got A'shaun Robinson. Notice the splits. You got wider splits inside. You got A'shaun Robinson, and you got Reed. All these guys are doing is sealing here, you're here, and you're bringing the defensive tackles in there. Coach, me and you can score that touchdown.
I tell you what, you only can do this if you got a great center.
It's a double ISO.
It's not a killer, but he occupies that guy. and it was all about spacing. It all started with a play, big play on defense.
Doug is up next. Doug in Georgia, good evening. How are you?
Hey, how are you, Paul and guys?
Very well.
Just wanted to make
an
observation here. With Florida State beating Auburn head-to-head ACC versus SEC a few years ago, and tonight, clearly we've got a tie game, but Clemson is obviously the better team. So when Clemson pulls away and wins this thing, at what point will you?
Hold on, hold on, Doug. Hold on. Time out, Doug. Clemson, I know you made the call and it looked like Alabama was about to surrender, but how do you say Clemson is the better team?
I mean, they were up a score. I mean, they threw a pick to get Alabama within range to score
Coach,
the touchdown. If they don't make any mistake.
You had Alabama beaten at halftime. Did you get the win?
No. That's why it's a four-quarter game. And you know what? Fans are entitled to every call, every play.
Doug, thanks for the trip. Give it a shot a little bit later on when we get a final score, okay, pal?
No, I think that Clemson is playing really, really
Absolutely.
Well. They're not blinded by the lights.
No.
They've responded, obviously, to the adversity early. The touchdown, they had a nice kick return, got right back on track, have had a couple big plays. They're winning.
Just want to check, because Phyllis had a coronary arrow. Phyllis, you feeling a little better right now?
Yeah, I'm on the oxygen. I'm calming down. We got another touchdown. I'm telling you, this is a dogfight. This is not going to be easy.
We know that, Phyllis, but about 30 minutes ago, you were already waving number 16. So just calm down. Call us after every Alabama touchdown, okay?
I don't know who jumps to conclusions faster, Phyllis. You
say,
or Paul?
Oh, there's
tide,
no question. I do.
Tide.
Paul jumps to conclusions.
I had given Alabama the win, and I'd already given Alabama the loss. I don't waste time, Coach.
It's all right. You're entitled to opinion.
Phyllis, we'll talk to you later.
I think that just, you know, these games are about managing the situation. Not being too high with the highs or low with the lows.
Steady. Chris, go right ahead. You're in Indianapolis.
Yeah.
Chris?
Yeah, you guys touched on it earlier. If I'm Alabama, I run right at Shaq Lawson. His knee does not seem right to me, and I don't know why Alabama just doesn't do that all day.
Boy, he looks tired, too. Because he hasn't been practicing either.
Exactly,
right,
Coach.
You're absolutely right.
So let's take that a step further. If he is ineffective, how does that affect the game as we head to the second half?
That's a balance that the coaches got to figure out over there. D-line coach has got to go to the coordinator and say, hey, he's playing, but it's not going well. Put that next best guy in. And my guess is they probably got a really good player behind him as well.
The thing is, though, I think also.
Okay, let me bring in Joe Scarborough. I was on his show early this morning. Joe, thank you very much for the call, the host of on MSNBC Morning Joe. Joe, good evening.
Good evening, Paul. We're going to get you on the show tomorrow morning.
We hope so. If the game ever ends.
If the game.
What do you think so far?
And hopefully we'll have some good things to talk about.
What are your impressions so far from Manhattan?
Well, you know, I'm actually, you know, my son, big Alabama fan, graduated, called me up before the game, said, oh, we're going to go be ahead 14-21-0. The second quarter is going to be like Notre Dame. I never really expected that. I mean, I thought the Sooners coming in, the Final Four were going to be the best team, and Clemson manhandled them. I mean, I expect a great game. But, you know, the one thing I've learned about the team this year is that not to worry about things in the first or the second quarter, wait for the third and wait for the fourth quarter. And, you know, we start to wear every team we play down, and Henry starts running downhill. And I think the same thing's going to happen here, like you guys said. Clemson's got one or two guys that are beaten up and are looking tired. And I think the game all comes down to us being able to, our defense being able to handle their schemes. And if we can do that, I think we'll be fine. But it's a lot better game right now than I expected.
It was so funny. These guys may have been sleeping this morning, but the piece you ran interviewing all the presidential candidates picking this game considering the South Carolina primaries coming up. Just hilarious, Joe.
They were total suck-ups. Chris Christie especially. I said, Chris, you should be ashamed of yourself. You're only saying it because it's the first primary in the South. He goes, it is? I had no idea. But I got to give Mike Huckabee credit. The governor from Arkansas said what I always say, which is, you know, you root for the SEC, and he said, I'll root for the SEC even when it's LSU as an Arkansas fan, and that's hard. And, you know, I was tested when Auburn played Oregon, but somebody said right before the game, he said, well, I know who you're going for. I go, no, you probably don't. It's not Oregon. I always root for the SEC. I don't care if it's Auburn. I don't care if it's LSU. I don't care if it's Tennessee. So,
final question, Joe. Who do you think Trump's pulling for tonight?
I think Trump's pulling for himself. I think Trump always pulls for himself. But he would. I think because he's running, he'd be equally shameless and be cheering for Clemson. But you know, listen. You know, it's really interesting. And we were talking about it before. I started at Alabama in 1981. Suffered with Alabama from 81, for the most part, other than 92 through 2007, 2008. It's kind of strange having people come up to me and, like, everybody being against my team saying that we're like the Yankees because we're so good. But you know what? That's a burden I happily carry as a Bama fan.
Joe, they're taking us to the break, but I can't thank you enough. I had a blast this morning. I hope we can work it out again tomorrow morning.
Yeah, come back on tomorrow morning, Paul. Thank you so much. Love you guys. Roll Tide.
Joe, thank you so much. Joe Scarborough, as we headed to the break, with the game time.
Welcome back to Feinbaum Film Room, presented by AT&T.
We're back on the Film Room as this game has taken some interesting turns. Coach Bielema, Clemson looked a little out of sorts there.
That was the first time, in my opinion, that they had looked a little rattled. Had a third down route run short by a receiver. Really didn't seem in sync. Thought it was interesting for the third series in a row. There was a quarterback design run game the first play of the game, but went to a second and five and couldn't convert.
Notice something I've seen also. Alabama made an adjustment. Instead of bringing four-man pressure, they're bringing five-man pressure with a twist inside. So they're going to try to use the twist to give Watson different looks.
Good
in the quarterback run game.
Good first play here. Some positive yards.
Coach, those are body blows.
Yeah.
You love that, right?
I would. I'd do it up again. I think the big thing that Alabama knows what they're patenting for is this is a four-quarter game. There was nobody on that sideline was worried when it was 14-7.
Cam Robinson, the Alabama left tackle, he has been having one heck of a game so far, guys.
And look who's down. Mackenzie Alexander.
Wow. Looks like it might be.
Perhaps the best defender. I know that Shaq Lawson will be a top pick in the NFL draft. But this guy right here, I'm telling you, I'm not sure there's a corner in the country better than him.
Yeah, grabbing that hamstring.
Coach, we talked about Shaq Lawson, and now this at the worst possible time in the game.
Yeah, it looked like a knee, too. So not even quite sure if it's the hammy, but looks like his knee was holding pretty hard. And he's a very talented player. Oh, here you see, jumps on the back for a ride.
Knee get, looks like he fell on
ankle, maybe on the inside, landed someone on it. But just saw that right leg. Never want to speculate, but obviously.
It's a game of emotion. Alabama, everything was going wrong. Now Clemson is entering the dark zone.
And just a little side note there, anytime their number two is tackling their number two, that's a good thing.
Yeah.
That's a good thing for Bama.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, you want that matchup all day long.
That spells number two for Clemson.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
One who's having a nice game is number 10 for Clemson, Ben Boulware. He had a pretty good game against – he's a linebacker. He plays the will spot. He had a pretty good game against Oklahoma, diagnosing, recognizing, and he's a good football player.
We heard from Joe Scarborough a minute ago. Now let's hear from Marcus Spears. Marcus, what do you see so far, man?
Man, it's very interesting. I think whatever scheme – to me, it's looking like whosoever scheme can stand the test of time – is going to end up winning this football game. It's been interesting to see Alabama. They've been very cautious in the rush, and it's a fine line in between rushing with an edge and trying to be cautious and make sure Deshaun Watson doesn't get out of the pocket. I think they just need to let loose but stay with a disciplined pass rush. I see a lot of guys tied up 1 or 2 yards behind the line of scrimmage instead of going forward and trying to rush the pass.
Well, you know, Spears, also a couple of times Tim Williams lost contain coming around the edge. Coach Bielema and I were talking about it. Even when you rush good, you got to keep contain around the edge because Deshaun Watson found the edge a couple of times.
Yeah, I think sometimes in these situations, especially with the quarterback.
You know as well as anybody, once you let the quarterback get outside of the pocket, the whole field opens up for him. So what you want to do is condense the pocket and keep him in between – both of his tackles and make it uncomfortable with the guys pushing in the middle of the pocket. But, you know, you see the turnover happen with Eddie Jackson. He gave up a touchdown play. The thing that I liked that I watched was when Nick Saban went to everybody and said, guys, let's settle down. We know who we are. Let's continue to be who we are and not get rattled. And it looks to me now that Clemson is on that other side. But it's just it's an interesting game so far. Both teams have kind of been trying to protect against what each other does well.
Got a nice run.
And it's been interesting.
Notice where they're running, though, Paul, behind number 74. Right now, to me, the best player on the field tonight has been Cam Robinson.
He's up to 115 yards.
Everything they're running is either to the left or it starts right and cuts back to the left behind 74.
Marcus, what do you think about the Shaq Lawson situation, just on what you've seen so far?
I think it's devastating. They're singling Shaq Lawson out, and they have an all-SEC left tackle, and they're going to tell him, if we can get you to move this guy and let two get downhill, then we can make hay on this defense. I don't know if I'm too far ahead, but it seems to me that this run game and pounding is already getting to Clemson a little bit, and they're starting to think about how are we going to defend this for four quarters.
Great point, Marcus.
You see a heavy body right here coming in. Lawson not on the field. Here on third and inches.
For Coach, your two best defensive players aren't on the field right now.
It's a blow emotionally, but, I think the biggest thing they got to do is, again, they can make a stop right here, get a chance right before the end of the half. It'll be interesting.
Strength to the field. Okay, two tight ends to the field, one receiver up top. If I'm a betting man, it's going to be a Derrick Henry run, start to the right, cut it back to the left.
It looks like we got two big A gaps again.
Started right, cut it back left.
I'll tell you what, they're spreading those two tackles out, and Clemson should have some type of, I guess in the second half, they'll really look at this, some type of take-it call.
What do you think's going on?
When they get those big A gaps, hit it.
With McKenzie over
here. They're putting ice on the hamstring. That means he's done, Paul.
Marcus, your thoughts on that?
Yeah, that is devastating. And, guys, we talked about that a little bit before this game even started. With both of those guys being questionable, we didn't find out about McKenzie later on. But with both of those guys being questionable, now you wonder what does this do to the psyche of the team that one of two of your best defenders is out of the game. And Shaq Lawson is obviously not 100%. So I think it's a huge blow.
Sure.
I think it's a huge blow.
Mark, Greg, let me ask you. You know Lane Kiffin. What's he thinking about right now? Is he thinking about taking a shot?
Keep running it. Right now, the only thing you're worried about is the workload that Derrick Henry's getting.
Yeah.
Derrick Henry right now at 18 carries.
There we go.
A little play action.
Backside of it.
Two hands.
Again.
Yeah.
I'll tell you what, I mean.
Looks very frustrated there, doesn't he? For good reason, but.
Yeah, Jay Coker held that ball way too long.
Yeah, he's got to understand that it doesn't matter how good his left tackle's playing.
I mean, 1,001, 1,002, 1,003, 1,004, that ball's got to be gone.
And there's nothing open downfield. He's got to understand, look, if nothing's there, where's my back? Where's my check down? Back's not there. Let's ride.
Yep.
North and south.
I think you said it, Paul, right
take
there. You
off.
Can see his frustrations. Third and 10.
Exactly. Yeah. Take off, Spears. I hear you.
Take off. You got to take off in that situation. Jay Coker is a formidable athlete. And look at the hole that he has. You got one linebacker in the middle of the field. Take off.
I just don't understand.
What a
you're
pass
running
rush
the ball
move
well.
By Shaq Lawson.
I don't understand why you run the ball well, why you drop back on second and five.
Just keep running it. Sometimes you outsmart yourself.
Football.
Coach, you have a very powerful running game. What's your message to your offensive coordinator? Is it just keep feeding them, or do you say, okay, let's hit one on the play action?
You know what? To be quite honest, that game plan goes in. I say very little during the course of the game. I'll do little reminders when we're out of the series. But obviously, he really felt that there was a chance here to get something downfield. One there, so now they're going to be in a defensive mode. There's worse things than putting your defense back out there.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
There's nothing ever wrong with a drive that ends in a kick, huh, Coach?
No.
They've made the difference-making play so far.
It's
a game of emotions as we watch Alabama and Clemson tied 14-14 in the second quarter. Coach Bielema, Marcus has joined us. Also, Booger McFarland and Greg McElroy, and your phone calls.
This was the first down
play. Yeah, that's the first down play.
I mean, guys, that's Vince Young right there.
Yeah,
that's what you're looking like. I mean, that's the type of player that he's capable of being.
Going more and more empty as the play goes long.
Nice play
to Artavis Scott there.
Nice play against pressure against Alabama. You love getting screens any way you possibly can. A nice design, too.
Yep. Number four, Eddie Jackson, he's got to shoot his gun there. He went around the block instead of shooting his gun and knifing up in there.
Snap for 25 seconds on a first down play. That's amazing.
Make the tackle. Here comes Reggie Ragland.
Lineman downfield, 73. That should be called right there. You go back and take a look at this.
Yeah, I don't see it. There it is. There's a flag.
You should have a lineman.
I was wondering if the Pac-12 was going to call that. The Pac-12 crew, you know, you can't count on them.
Pac-12 supervisor listening to Greg right there.
I want you guys to take a look at this real quick.
I think he's winning. He's leaving, you know. Yeah. This wasn't a design play. This is one of those that happened, you know.
All right, I want you to take a look right here. Watch number 73. He's the right tackle. And watch him just leak a little bit downfield as soon as Deshaun starts to exit and run around a little bit. Look, it's hard on those guys, man.
Right.
I mean, it's really hard. And you can see, here's the three-line window. I mean, that's 3 yards right there.
Mm-hmm.
If my math's correct, that's actually four. Or finger accuracy, whatever it may be. He's past the 3 yards. It's a nice job by the Pac-12 officiating group recognizing it and getting it taken care of.
He was actually trying to get back. The rule reads, if your back foot is 3 yards or more or less, we're legal, so...
Wow. What a play by Reuben Foster.
That guy right there, man. That is the difference to me at the linebacker position for Alabama. Trey Dupree, where he struggled at times running sideline to sideline. Reuben Foster athletically has been absolutely off the charts.
I mean, that was just unbelievable speed to see it, to diagnose it, and to have the speed and athleticism to get outside and make a one-on-one tackle in the open field.
Like we said earlier, not a lot of missed tackles in this game.
Bama's got their pass rush group in. There's Williams. Yeah.
That guy right there that just made the play. I have the depth chart right here for Alabama.
Yeah.
Number three.
Deshaun Hamm.
Coach, third not that you're there too often, but what is your favorite third and 22 play?
Draw a screen.
Yeah, something to make sure you just don't make something catastrophic. You already got a bad situation.
I think Coach knows a little something about not 23, but 26, 4th and 26.
Fourth and 20.
Oh, look out.
4th and 25.
In red zone, that's easy.
Coach's
I've
spot.
Seen that play once
that's,
or twice.
That's drawn up.
Yeah, this is going to be some type of draw screen. Watch out.
Okay, they have not done that in a while. They did it there, and that was a big play. You talk about a game of emotions. Booger, we were in Dallas with Greg last week at the end of the half, and we were complaining about Alabama. They made a play at the end of the half, and the game – changed dramatically.
Guys, let's take a look at the last play. We've been talking about Clemson and Deshaun Watson's ability to get outside. Here's what we mean by contained rush. The defensive end gets up the field and then comes back. Don't allow the quarterback to go outside. Get to the quarterback's level.
Actually, watch how they get Rashawn Evans involved. He's going to spin around to the outside. And it's a nice job by Williams becoming a little bit of a decoy. Sliding inside and allowing one-on-one rush against a running back who's not going to be as good a protection.
Alabama, let's go with their last time. I thought it was interesting. They lost about somewhere around 12 to 15 seconds, I believe. The play clock was down to 26 when they finally called a timeout. They had one to spend. Now they're going to go ahead and do it. So some critical time loss there. Be interesting how that plays out here.
I wonder, you know, Coach, when do you decide to come after the kick a little bit here? You think maybe they're coming after it?
No, I would say they're setting up a return. He called a timeout. He wants to set up something. You got two guys back. They're going to overload the one side of the shield. Clemson does the two-man shield, which is a little bastardized. Hard to get in when he does the rugby stuff.
Do you like the rugby punch, Coach? What's the advantage of it?
Two things. First, you got to be sound. Actually, this guy is able to punt both ways, right and left.
Yeah.
An ambidextrous punter doesn't come along every day, so that's a very unusual situation. An Australian guys kind of do it, but it's very hard to pressure it. Even so, they brought four guys to the right side. Now they just rolled the other way, totally away from their pressure.
Jonathan in Panama City, good evening. Welcome to the film room.
Hey, Paul, how you doing? Booger, I'm representing the 318 for you down here in Florida. Just want to ask everyone on the show tonight, Coach, going into the second half in the post game like this, big game, what's your message to the players and for Booger and Greg? What are you thinking as a player on the field, going into the second half?
I'm trying to get points right here.
Yeah, I would say.
I'm not thinking about the second half yet.
Oh, my.
Once again, Greg.
I'm telling you, he's got to understand.
Thanks for the call.
Now, you might see Clemson take a timeout right here. Now it's a first and extra long. It'll be interesting to see.
Why are we seeing this, Greg?
Well, you can see right here, he just doesn't recognize and doesn't step up in the pocket enough. He gets comfortable thinking he has extra protection. You see Green, the tight end on the right-hand side, 300-pound tight end, essentially a tackle that can run routes. He gets beat around the edge and thinks he has extra protection, doesn't step up hard enough. This Clemson team is a good pass-rushing group. Mm-hmm. Right now, though, you have to recognize, as the Alabama offense coordinator, Lane Kiffin's got to run the football right now.
He's going to run it.
And ice it.
Very surprised. Dabo's not taking a timeout, Coach. Nice. A lot of time.
Now, you might get a push call right here. They might call it quick, just to make a punt.
Right, yeah. I mean, it was about 30 seconds to run off the clock.
He stopped it. So they had three timeouts, so he stopped it. So he's going to at least make him punt the football. The one thing Alabama probably didn't want to do is take a sack.
Yeah.
You got lost yardage. Clock, just kills you in that situation.
Defense for Alabama has tightened up, though.
Mm-hmm.
They've played a little bit better. Let's remind ourselves what happened in a two-minute situation before the half against Michigan State. Michigan State tried to go down, steal some points, got a little greedy, mm-hmm. Connor Cook did, on a little fade route to the left-hand side. Cyrus Jones made kind of a game-changing play.
Yeah.
So Alabama has been a little vulnerable in the last week when it came to giving up yards, but they didn't give up points before the half. So Dabo's going to try to make sure they get an opportunity to play a little offense.
And I got to think, if you're Dabo Swinney, you're very happy right now. Okay, it's 14-14, you got one turnover, and you're going to have the ball with probably about a minute left and a couple of timeouts, maybe one timeout. And if you want to put a little bit more pressure on Alabama, you can. If not, you can go into halftime. And I think Clemson would take a tie ball game at halftime, Coach.
I think they both would at this point. Just a nice, easy throw here. You're going to see a timeout big time coming right as soon as the ball goes dead.
For those of you out there, we are going to be here the entire half. So
two timeouts.
We're guessing more commentary.
They absolutely did not want to run out.
Big injury there.
And that's Bullaware, the Will linebacker. He's been having a nice game, nice couple games for Clemson.
Critical thing here was the clock was stopped. Injury timeout, it won't cost them. Boy, Bullaware's down. It could be their top three defensive players. We're down.
They played well so far in spite, but it's a long way to the end.
And that's just a poor decision to run out of bounds right there.
Right.
Timeouts are like gold in this situation.
He lined up as the wide receiver on the far left side. By the time he got over there, he's probably...
I don't think he was thinking about
when's this play going to end? They just ran 70 yards and I gained two.
Let's keep in mind, as good as Calvin Ridley's been, he is a freshman.
Yes.
And those are things that you have to keep in mind. You see him shaking his head.
Coming. They're coming, boys. Look for something coming back across the center's face here. They lined up overload to the Clemson right. They may come across the center's face.
Alabama personal protector stepped up, made a little check.
Guy came in the left leg. They picked it up.
Not a bad punt.
That was very good.
What's your philosophy, Coach, on fair catches when you're trying to block?
Well, I think right there, the only two guys that were holding up were the two wide guys. That came with an eight-man pressure. So there was only one, only two guys holding up. They just told them, no matter what, take the fair catch.
It's been a game of big plays so far. I mean, you think about the 50-yard run.
Mm-hmm.
You think about the long throw down the right-hand side. There's been some big plays on both sides, and I think that's a big reason why the score is sitting at 14-all.
It's also been a game of adjustments. Deshaun Watson was hurting them earlier. You've seen Alabama go to more of an inside pressure look where they're bringing guys inside. A lot of stunts up front here lately. There's another stunt inside.
Quarterback run?
Yeah.
Nope. Oof.
It's a nice throw.
Stepped up.
He's really done a good job keeping his eyes downfield. Been effective on the ground, but
he looks calm, boy. He looks really calm.
Alabama has been so effective, Coach, closing halves. LSU, Michigan State. This is important here for them.
Nice one-on-one rush. Nice one-on-one rush by Tim Williams. Nice one-on-one rush by Tim Williams. We can go back and take a look at that, Greg.
Quick peek, see a little spin move.
Yeah, take a look at our guy Tim Williams. Come up here. Nice little spin move at the level. Great little one-on-one rush here.
Yeah, really nice rush. Watch him here.
Get him back inside.
That's a nice
job. That's how you get to the level of the quarterback and keep Deshaun Watson inside.
It's like basketball. You're in the post, you got it inside, give him a little.
Dude, you're 6 foot. What do you know about the post?
Come on, man. Played tough. Played big.
Let's be honest.
Played 6'4".
Played bigger than you are, huh?
Hey, it was great on JV as a senior. Come on, man, in high school.
Nick looks pretty frustrated.
Yeah, it was a little. I'd like to see the caption there.
At some point, they're going to have to make the adjustment to roll back because they just haven't been able to affect Deshaun Watson, especially as he's moved in the pocket.
Yeah.
Well, another empty lined up empty. Another four-man rush.
Yeah. We've seen empty a lot here.
Yep. Again, so we can see what's going on. Uh-oh. Clock stops.
And they got one timeout, so.
All goes back to the set.
Spike
right?
It right here.
Jack and Poker set the clock.
With 4 o'clock
operation.
I'd ask him to take a, yeah, I think Dabo's mad. That was way, they probably took an extra 2 to 3 seconds off that clock.
Yeah, because on first down, the clock stopped.
He crossed the chains at 14. I would say they're going to go back and add some time here.
Yeah, he crosses it at 14, should hold.
And it was on 6.
Yeah.
It's, yeah, they might go back.
Held at 12 for a half second.
Yeah, the ball wasn't even set.
Watch out, don't touch the official, Dabo. The only thing that gets scary there, you know, you get your emotions.
Have you ever bumped one, Coach?
Well, no. I bumped one, but I got flagged for it. But then that's a whole other story. I also said something to him. But I think you saw the game the other night, the NFL game. Pittsburgh game affected by emotions.
Yes, right. Yes.
And Dabble's as cool and as calm, but he's pissed right now, and that's the result. So they put 3 on.
And here, this Greg Hugo, one of the best kickers in the country. Alabama's blocked a couple kicks now, though. They're capable. They're pretty long inside. There it was.
I think they got a piece of that one.
I think they got tipped.
Yeah. I think they tipped it. There it is.
How important was that, Chris?
Big one there.
That is huge, guys. The momentum that you get coming into the half.
Because Clemson, you did everything right.
Everything you could possibly
do. You did everything right.
Steal points. Get the sack of Jake Coker on your defensive drive. Let's take a peek and see who got a piece of this one.
Ooh, looks like Petway inside.
Petway.
Petway inside.
I don't think
he got it. Yeah, is that Cyrus Jones didn't get it coming off the edge. I think inside it was Petway, though.
This will be the angle right here. Good snap, good hold.
He's got a big push.
Petway, number 57.
Yep, little tip of it.
And of all the guys that would block it, Petway sits at 6'3", Bug.
By the way,
got 4 inches taller.
We cannot confirm or deny whether the clock operator went to Alabama.
Yeah, exactly.
There we go. I mean, Alabama's really been good when it comes to blocking kicks this year, not just punts.
They're always good.
They have three. You guys lost
by
one.
We lost by 1 point.
As a result of
a missed field goal and a block VAT.
In 2014. Oh, and this... Just a little
more yards,
just
Derek.
A little momentum.
Yeah, just a reminder. Hey, this is what you're gonna get in the second half.
2 missed field goals, Coach.
Yeah, that's big. You know, it was interesting. I think the emphasis in a kicking game because you start talking about all these offense defense, but look what's been the difference. Alabama jumps out. What's Clemson do? Answers with a long kickoff return. Mm-hmm. Gets a score. 2 field goals. Special teams. Just huge, huge parts.
Coach, one really feels great because it's been that type of game. But
I tell you what, it's fun.
Who feels better though?
Yeah, I think Clemson. You're happy. You're going in. I mean, I know you're upset at the end of the game there not to get a field goal, but you're 14-14 in a game that no one said you could win. On the flip side, Alabama maybe hasn't played all that great, but they're in a very, very tight ball game.
Let's go to Steve in West Monroe, Louisiana. What's up, Steve?
Hey, fellas, thanks for taking my call. First of all, Brett, I am a big Arkansas fan. Woo Pig Suey.
Woo Pig. Absolutely.
Hey. And Booger, Mickey Dubose here in West Monroe says hello.
Tell Mickey I said hello, man.
All right.
What's on your mind, Steve?
It looks like who's going to wear out, Deshaun Watson or the Alabama defense. He's taking some big hits, and Alabama's running all over the place trying to catch him. I don't know who's going to. Who's going to last? I mean, he's taking a big hit on the hip. I don't know if y'all saw that play earlier.
Yeah, thanks for the call, Steve. Let's get a report from an Alabama fan. Larry, how many beers?
Woo! Baby, I'm already on 18, son. I ain't even started taking ass.
Hey, hold on. Larry, this is our annual 18 beers at halftime.
Yes, sir. That ain't nothing, son. This is Alabama National Championship. Hey, brother, I'm going to knock out.
Okay, Larry. Okay, we'll catch back up with you later. 18 beers.
Hey,
please.
Let me ask you might be doing a little more beers. Tell Phelan I love you.
Okay, Larry. Okay, he loves you. Okay, Larry, good deal, buddy.
I think one thing to keep in mind here as we get this thing back on track, we love you, Larry.
He could double that number.
Easily.
I think we also need to keep in mind, let's also think a little bit about how both these teams played in the second half last week. You know, I mean, think about how Oklahoma had the lead at halftime. Yeah. Clemson poured it on in the second half. Alabama up 10-0 against Michigan State. Michigan State just had their best offensive possession, finished the game 38-0. So two second-half teams. It'll be interesting to see the adjustments that are made. But I think the most important drive of the half of the game, Coach, is Clemson's first drive.
I would agree. Now, you know, the flip side of this. Now, at halftime, Alabama's been here, done this. They been in some halftime games. We were up on them, you know.
Yeah.
And you talk about Tennessee in the fourth quarter. Clemson has pretty much done what they wanted. I mean, they had two or three tight games.
What about the defensive injury situation? What toll will that take?
Well, Boulware didn't look like it was too serious, but you lose your number one corner. I don't care how good you are. That's going to hurt you in a big way. And obviously the defensive end is playing but not playing great. But it'll be interesting because that could be a big factor in the fourth quarter.
You know, Shaq Lawson, he's played, but just like we thought he would, he's not been effective. Dodd has actually had a better game, couple of sacks. It's been interesting, Paul. You know, we talked about the game. What kind of game plan would Alabama have? It's a running football game tonight. Henry, way over 100 yards.
Let's bring a man in who won the national championship at Alabama in 1992. He also coached Dabo Sweeney and has mentored him. Coach Stallings, good evening. Thank you so much for being with us.
Listen, it's a great first half we've watched.
Let's get your impression. Certainly, you have so many friends at Alabama and so many friends and former players and coaches at Clemson. How do you think it went?
Well, I thought it was just an outstanding first half. Clemson scored two touchdowns throwing the football, but they threw that interception, and that made a difference. And Alabama's running game, they hadn't been able to stop it. They slowed it down a little bit, but Henry still got off two nice runs, scored two touchdowns. What I think needs to happen in the second half, I think Alabama needs to protect their quarterback a little bit better, and they need to contain Clemson's quarterback. I think that's the key, and I think what Clemson needs to do is stop the run, which they've tried to do, but obviously hadn't been able to do it, and capitalize on their passing game.
Well, I think the big thing, too, as we go forward with this, the one turnover, I guess anybody would pray to get out of a game like this with just two turnovers in the game overall.
Yeah, if we see, it was a big turnover. The defensive player made an outstanding play on the ball. So it was a well-thrown ball, just made a great play.
I think the big part as we go forward, too, is, you know what, as the game kind of unfolded a little bit there, Clemson looked like they got rattled and got their mojo back in the second half. They're going to start off here or at the end of the game. They're starting off. This is a big drive for them.
Coach Stallings, Derrick Henry averaging 6.5 yards a carry. Your thoughts on Lane Kiffin's offensive philosophy in the first half?
First of all, 6 yards a carry doesn't really say anything. What percent of the time does he make 6 yards? You know, to take the 50-yard run out, and they've contained him pretty well, but you can't take it out. Short yardage, they had those two big people in front of him, so he's going to make that touchdown. I thought Clemson has done a fair job with the exception of that one run. Of course, you can't take that out. That made the difference in the interception. But I thought it was a great first half. I worry a little bit about Clemson losing some of their players. Looks like Alabama.
Yeah, that's what I wanted to ask you about. You're a defensive coach, of course. What impact, as the game plays out, do you think those injuries will cause Clemson?
It'll hurt them. I mean, you can't lose a defensive cornerback, a good one, and be as good as you were. The year that we won it, everybody stayed healthy. That was one of the reasons. Clemson's lost a player or two, and Alabama hadn't, and that makes a difference in the game. Alabama's got to protect their quarterback, though.
Coach Stallings, Booger here. What do you make of Jay Coker? He looks very rattled. He's holding the football too long. What do you see from the Alabama quarterback so far?
Well, I think that he needs to get rid of the football. They need to protect him a little bit better. Clemson has done a pretty good job covering him downfield, and And Jake has not thrown many bad passes, and he didn't turn the ball over, so it's better just go ahead and take the sack. And they got a good punter and forced Clemson to go 70, 80 yards with it.
Coach, you've obviously been in a situation like this. However, in 1992, it was a very one-sided affair against Miami. If you're Nick Saban, what is your message to the team as you take the field in the second half?
Well, the first 5 minutes of the second half is awfully important, and Clemson gets the football. So they've got to back their ears and stop them and maintain some field position. And when they take over the ball, they've got to be at least on the 40-yard line. So that's the message that he's going to be telling his team.
Coach, we took the 50-yard run out of Derrick Henry's total. He's averaging the rest of the time he's averaging 3.7 yards a carry.
Yeah, that's when I used to is what percent of the time does he make it 4 yards? Not the average, it really doesn't make any difference if somebody can make a 50, 60-yard run.
What do you expect out of Clemson in this first possession?
I think that they're going to throw the football. That's where they've had the success. They take the quarterback out from running. They hadn't run the ball at all. Alabama's got to contain Clemson's quarterback if they're going to win the game, and Clemson has got to stop the running game if they're going to win.
Coach, I know you want to get back to watching the game. We really appreciate your time, and always great to catch up.
Well, I'm thoroughly enjoying watching the game, and thank you guys for what y'all do and the way you promote the game.
Thank you, Coach. Coach Gene Stallings, as we continue here at halftime, getting reaction. We talked about that first series, and certainly that's going to be very important. Let's go to Fayetteville. No, this is not your wife calling. It is Lynn calling. Good afternoon. Actually, good evening, Lynn. Good evening, and welcome to our show.
Yes, sir. Thank you. I just want to ask Coach B a question. Coach, I'm looking at this game, and I'm just kind of wondering why Bama's not playing to their strength. I mean, they've got a great offensive line. They got the Heisman Trophy winner, and I think we're just calling too many pass plays that are giveaway plays. And
Let me get Coach to react to that. Thanks, Lynn.
Yeah, I think you're obviously, some people are going to say that. I think Lane would tell you that they see some things down the field. But obviously the quarterback is a little rattled. I don't know what the exact scenario is going into it. I always like to see post-snap reactions. And twice when he's had failure, he slammed the ball on the ground. And that's a sign that your quarterback's rattled. An easy way to put his mind at ease is let number two go to work, maybe throw some receiver reverses around and some other things just to keep the ball on the ground and keep it safe as well.
Let's put some stats on the board here and let you guys react to what has happened so far. We've talked about, obviously, Henry's numbers, and there are so many other ones to react to as well, which we'll get to in a minute. Again, let's take a look, guys.
You can see it. I mean, obviously, Jake Coker has a couple good throws, had a nice screen a little earlier in the football game to Calvin Ridley on the first third down, but not big-time opportunities down the field. They've dropped him back 17 times, or 18 times, excuse me. He ran once and was sacked 4 times, so adjusting on the fly, making sure that he's throwing the ball on time and accurately, because some of the guys have been pretty tightly covered.
And then you look at the other side, Deshaun Watson. He's got to do it all, guys. He's 12 for 18 for 162. He's got another almost 49 or 50 yards rushing. He's the entire Clemson offense. I do not think that Deshaun Watson by himself can beat Alabama. He's going to need some help from Gallman or some of the other guys, maybe Artavis Scott in the passing game. Right now, Derrick Henry, 20 carries. We talked about him having well over 30 to 40 carries in this game. He's well on his way, Coach, and I think you're going to see more and more. As Jake Coker holds the football and looks very indecisive in the pocket, Nick is going to turn around and hand it to number two over and over and over again. He's not going to put the game in Coker's hands, who doesn't look really good right now.
I don't mean to oversimplify it, but if the MVP of this game is Henry, Alabama wins. If it's Deshaun Watson, Clemson wins. That's it. Who is the best player on both teams, and how much better are they going to be in the second half? That's what it gets down to. You can throw all the other stuff out. I mean, barring a freak, turnover, kicking game, whatever. But if those two players, whoever plays better in the second half, their team wins.
Your thoughts on Lane Kiffin's selection?
You know, I'm a big fan of Lane. They do some creative things. I thought we might see Ridley a little bit more, to be quite honest. But they might also be doing some things. The angles that we've seen, it looks like they've had someone pressuring him in his face right away. He's definitely been their go-to guy after that Ole Miss game. I saw he'd been the main target 10 of 11 games since then. So that has not been a factor. I think he's touched the ball three times.
Just curious how they're going to get Jake Coker on rhythm. I think some early throws, maybe a slant, quick out. You're seeing very aggressive play at the line of scrimmage for some of the Clemson secondary players. What are they going to do to try to get, like you said, Calvin Ridley involved, but also get Jake Coker in rhythm, feeling comfortable? Because I agree, Derrick Henry's the workhorse,
yeah.
But you have to be balanced against a good defensive coordinator like Brent Venables.
Let's go to Chase in Charleston next. Chase, thank you very much for the call. Good evening.
Howdy, Paul. How are you and the boys doing tonight?
Howdy. We're doing great.
What's
on your mind?
What a game, huh? It's been fun to watch. Hey, I got a quick question for you. That Uncle Mo, she's fickle now. How do you think all these momentum swings in the first half, how do you think they're going to affect the team's mentality in the second half?
What about it, Uncle Bert?
Uncle Mo.
We're going to there, partner. I thought they've handled it well. Again, we preach all the time as coaches. It's not what's happening. It's how you react to it. And there's been at least five or six textbook definitions in the first half by both teams really reacting well to bad situations. The only real big one there was the turnover and immediate score by Alabama. Not immediate, but went right down the field and scored. So I thought Clemson answered the bell after that, though.
I want to see what adjustments they make. It's punch, it's counterpunch. Early on, we saw Clemson getting the football out on the edge, Coach. Okay, then Alabama adjusted, and they said, you know what, let's get Deshaun Watson outside, throw the football against Minka Fitzpatrick in the slot. Then they took the shot down the field. Alabama adjusted by bringing their rushers inside, getting pressure in Deshaun Watson's face. What's going to be the halftime adjustment? I think they go back to the first thing, which is getting the ball outside and try to get Wayne Gallman involved a little bit, because he's been a non-factor so far.
Yeah, I think also the quarterback run game.
Yeah.
They've run them a few times on first down, had some success. But also, Alabama's got to do a much better job when, in fact, he leaves the pocket but still remains a passer. He's made two big throws down the field, also converted one with his legs on third and four.
Yeah.
They have to do a better job of closing when he runs and covering when he's trying to pass.
Yeah. Ed, you're in Reno, Nevada. Go right ahead. Good evening.
Yeah, I always look in these games for who can anticipate the snap count. It looks like about three series before the half, Alabama was really anticipating Clemson's snap count. What do you think?
Yeah, I mean, you don't want to be guessing the snap count. I mean, the ball moves, you move. I mean, that's an old adage as a defensive lineman. You just watch the ball. I don't think as a player you want to be guessing. Coach, I didn't teach. I mean, I wasn't taught to guess. Did you teach your guys to guess?
No, I thought Alabama has always traditionally played the snap count whenever it is very well. They're really good at getting their hands off the ball. I did look a little bit to me in the first half that Alabama was off the football a little bit more than they normally are. I don't know if it was just the angle we were getting in, but it looked like they were giving a lot of respect to Clemson, being able to come across the line of scrimmage, get their hands on him, and then manhandle him a little bit.
Coach, you had some great defensive linemen that could really rush the passer and Filon and Flowers, several more this year that have stepped up and come into their own. When you're facing a quarterback like this, you guys played Tennessee, you know what Josh Dobbs was capable of. How aggressive do you tell your defensive linemen that they have to be when they're rushing the passer?
You know, they get mad because the best pass rush against them would be, in my opinion, a hard bull rush on the outside edges, holding contained so you can't make – if they do flush him, you should be able to make a play. And then make him throw out of the hole, you know, continue to make those guards get knocked back so there's no angle for him to step up in. When one guy does an inside move, the other guy twice doesn't get outside, now he breaks contained. It's a huge, huge advantage for a quarterback to be on the move like he is.
And you know, Bama's adjustment, Coach, to your point, we call it a mush rush where you just try to mush it up in there. Bama did some of that, but what they're also doing is they're taking the middle linebacker, bringing the defensive end, running some stunts outside. They're doing whatever they can do to create confusion in front of Watson. You don't want him seeing a clear lane. Anytime you got bodies crossing his face, now he's going to be a little bit more indecisive.
I'll be really honest. I am really surprised with how well Clemson's offensive line has played. I thought that was a decided advantage in favor of Alabama. I thought that some of these guys, particularly the left tackle, Mitch Hyatt, true freshman, good football player, highly touted, highly recruited, he's played really well against a very formidable front. So I'll be interested to see if they're able to continue if Alabama continues to go with some of the games and stunts and twists and stuff like that that they started to use later in the second quarter, because that was somewhat effective as the game went on.
I'm glad you're being honest with us, too.
We understand that.
I'm being very honest.
Dabo Swinney chased the officials down. Your thoughts on that? Because, I mean, from here, it looked like he had a point.
As far as putting time on the clock. Yeah, and they put a little bit on, and I was actually surprised with 9 seconds, they didn't try one more five.
Because they had a timeout, yeah.
They did. I was a little confused.
Well, actually,
little
I don't think they got the timeout. He actually tried to call it, and then Deshaun Watson snapped it and spiked it. Right. So had they just allowed him to spike it, then they could have maybe taken a chance, improved the field goal by 5 yards. It was an interesting turn of events right there, but it certainly benefited Alabama.
You know, I think Coach brought up a great point at halftime there. Was we're kind of getting not a genuine picture. Henry hit the 50-yarder, but he hasn't hit a lot of big 6, 7, 8 yarders. They've been 4 or 5. There's a difference. Now you start hitting 7 yarders, 8 yarders, there's a little bit more of a first down ratio coming into effect. They have not been able to run the ball as effectively as I thought they were going to. On the flip side of it, Clemson hasn't really run it at all.
Yeah.
But the D-line hasn't been effective.
A couple of seconds left before we break. What do you see happening here? Who does this favor?
Well, I think Clemson's going to go into halftime, and I think Dabo Swinney's going to walk over to his quarterback and say, my man, it's your show. We're going to let you do what you do, and they're going to maybe let him run it a little bit more. They're going to let him get on the edge and throw the ball. I doubt if we see him back in the pocket throwing much. But on the flip side of it, if Alabama can contain just to get the quarterback under the normal way he's been playing, he doesn't need to be Superman. He just needs to be Jay Coker. He just needs to be the guy that has gotten to this game.
We'll continue. We'll grab more phone calls as we go to the half. Of course, for those of you wondering, this is an alternative to the game. We didn't take the game away from you. We'll continue with much more. Adam Griffith missed a big field goal. We'll take a break, come back with the second half of the national championship game live in Phoenix.
Welcome back to Feinbaum Film Room, presented by AT&T.
We welcome you back. We're about to start the second half of the national championship game. Coach Bielema, Booger, Greg McElroy, and let's talk about what we're going to see here. It's a big, big first series for Clemson.
You know, and again, when you're dealing with a new officiating crew, new clock crew, they're all going through it the first time. You're looking for signals, but the rule in college football is if you get a first down, the clock stops until the chains get moved. Bottom line, I don't think the clock ever stopped running, or for sure there should have been some extra time put on, which would allow Clemson to take maybe a play or two more before that field goal opportunity. Plus, they had a timeout on their side. We all agree
it was a bad call.
Yeah.
From what we've seen, it looks that way.
Yeah. I think it was poorly managed by the officials at the end of the half. And I think also, conversely, it was a little bit poorly managed by Clemson, too, trying to burn the timeout when Deshaun's under center getting ready to spike it. So I think both things were forgivable and things that you don't want to think
about. Here's a case in point, too, is that you can actually here it is. So he catches it. He's crossing the ball. Okay, the official waves his hands right here. That's at 13 seconds.
Should stop.
It goes down to 9. 10. 9. It just doesn't make sense.
Yeah, and that's the thing that Dabo's saying right there. Like, hey, guys, this doesn't make sense. And I think he's got every right to be a little upset there.
That's reviewable. You can review time on the clock.
Why didn't they?
Don't know.
This is the national championship game of college football.
You know, I guess because the clock didn't run out. I don't know if but I'm almost positive any type of stoppage in play issue with the clock, you can make a.
We'll come back in 2 hours and see how important that was.
Yeah. Especially with the missed field goal there.
Bottom line, the right guard didn't block the guy, and they got a blocked field goal.
Bad kick right here, too.
Nope.
Very short, very high.
A little fake reverse, too, there. You see that?
Yeah. I don't hate it. I like it.
Let me bring former Georgia coach Jim Donnan in. And Coach Donnan, thanks so much for the time. We've been talking about the clock management and the officiating at the end of the first half. How did you see it?
You got the choke factor. I mean, the guy choked. That's the only way to look at it. I mean, you got to be nice to these guys, and you guys are doing a good job. But, you know, when a guy makes a call like that, that really hurts you. And sometimes these guys have – and Brett sees it all the time. You got these guys when the band's playing, everybody in the country's watching them. You got to make the call, and they blew it.
Listen, once again, they came out, tried to get Gallman going. There's no way they can run the football, Coach. If I'm Dabo, hey, guys, let's just stop trying to run it up the middle with Gallman. Put the ball in your quarterback's hand. If they're going to win tonight, it's going to be because number four, not number nine.
Coach Donnan, you're an offensive coach. What do you think Clemson needs to do right now?
Well, you got to get the two auxiliary players for both teams going a little bit. I mean, Gallman's not going to be able to do much, but he's got to help them a little bit. And then Coker, they got to help him a little bit on trying to throw some rhythm throws instead of faking the 46 guys back there every time. I mean, let him go back there and throw it quickly. Ridley's caught six passes for 18 yards.
Third and two right now, Coach. What's your call?
This is the biggest play of the game so far.
I'm going to put it in number four's hands, that's for sure. You know, I think Ridley's made some good points about the fact that the pass rush, they're going to have to find a way to put some pressure on him without giving up the third down pickups because, you know, they've had a hard time.
Coach Donnan, how big of a momentum shift Clemson getting the ball, getting nothing for it? Alabama gets the ball now.
Well, I think it's huge because Alabama now has got a chance to come back with their second half plan, which would be Henry left, Henry right, Henry up the middle, and Henry all around every which way he can go.
Coach, we're a lot entertaining here, I'll say that.
Hey, dance with me, Henry. But, I mean, realistically, this game right here, Clemson's played out of their mind on defense without some of their best players. And I give them a lot of credit because they've mixed up some things and confused the quarterback a little bit. Greg can tell you that. I mean, it looks like he's really indecisive. And, you know, I think it's just a question of if Alabama can just assert itself now.
Coach, how would you grade Lane Kiffin in the first half?
Well, I mean, you know, I don't know what exactly some of the calls were, but I thought he did some good things. But, you know, it continues to baffle me in the red zone sometimes when they, you know, have to call timeout because they put so many guys in motion. But I'd say overall, you know, they've got 14 points, and I think they'll do a better job in the second half of settling down a little bit. Some of the things they thought they might could have done against Clemson hadn't worked out well. But I'd like to see a little more Drake, you know, in the two-back set and maybe give him fake to Henry and throw the ball on some screens and stuff like that.
What about Jacob Coker? What are you seeing in his play so far?
Well, he's been a little rattled, but, you know, he hadn't had a lot of good protection. They've hurt him with the inside rush. They really moved their fronts around, and Alabama hadn't done a very good job of protecting. But they're not a pass-protecting team. They're a play-action team, as Coach Bielema will tell you. But it's going to be interesting to see, kicking game-wise, all the things that are involved in a football game. You're going to see all those factors here in the second half.
Coach Donnan, many thanks. We'll talk later in the week to get your reaction. I know you liked Alabama in this game. We'll see how it turns out.
I still like them. Thank you.
You bet. Coach Jim Donnan, as we watch Alabama, try to get some momentum here, Coach Bielema.
Really nice. A little bit more composure, big hit,
wide open,
broken coverage. I was going to say there were some holes on those shots. Clemson's doing a lot of fire zones, a lot of matchup zone that had the potential to have something see through like that.
That is a huge, huge, huge start to the second half for Alabama. I mean, that is absolutely exactly what you want. Three and out defensively, offensively, albeit because of a blown coverage.
Yeah.
Touchdown tied. Very well done.
Momentum officially has swung and is hanging out on the Crimson sideline right now.
Boy, they managed by crisis over there, too. Did you see the beginning of that series?
Mm-hmm.
Everybody's yelling at one another, and just obviously things work out for the good players, but very, very key play for us, right? Play for Alabama right there.
And this is interesting right here. Just a complete blown coverage. Want to definitely take a look at it here.
Yeah.
It's a good job by Jay Coker recognizing it, too, because sometimes you can see a lot of guys running free, but you see them on Monday after you watch the tape.
Exactly.
You don't see them while you're out there on the field. Well done by Jay Coker. It's good for him to get into it also confidence-wise. Speaking of confidence, Adam Griffith.
That looks shaky.
Needs to get a little confidence himself. Yeah. All right, let's take a look at it here. All right, I want you guys to see exactly what we're looking at. This is busted from the very beginning. Look at this. All right, you have two players for Alabama right here. You have two players for Clemson. Little man-to-man coverage. On the other side, however, two players for Alabama, one player for Clemson. That's simple math, Boog. If I'm not mistaken, two is greater than one.
Well, and then also, Greg, take a look at Clemson. They're going to bring a five-man pressure, basically singling guys in one-on-one situations. So I thought that was a very unique look, bringing pressure with five when you can't get pressure with your defensive line, who normally rushes four.
So you can see it right here, just completely uncovered, wide open. Safety T.J. Green, the one Alabaman that's on this Clemson football team. Eyes in the backfield, nobody home. Just busted coverage from the very beginning. Well done by Jake Coker, recognizing it, knowing he had two on one, and exploiting it for a touchdown.
You know, the other thing, too, as they lined up, you saw Lane about 20 yards of the football. I think he was pointing to throw the ball. He knew that there was a busted coverage. I know there's no sideline to quarterback communication.
Let's take a look at this booger.
Yeah, and it looks like Mackenzie Alexander, if I'm not mistaken. Street clothes.
He can't even walk on his own with that hamstring, so something must be kind of torn or something, you know, in the back of that hamstring or ligament or something.
It had to be the play before, because the play that they showed,
it looked
nothing
very
really
normal.
Happened.
Right. The only thing I saw was a guy landing on his right ankle.
Right, right.
It's just, it's so unfortunate. He really is one of my favorite defensive players in the country.
Yeah. Yeah,
he really does
player.
A nice
recruited
job.
Recruited him out of high school, very intense, competitive.
Yeah.
Everything that you want.
Coach, we've all seen this movie, you included, right now over on the Clemson side. How dire is it for them to make some good plays?
We saw Coach Saban come over and say, hey, calm down. In his own way. Now, Dabo is completely different than Coach.
Right.
But in his own way, he's got to get his players. It's just 7 points. It's just 7 points.
It is.
Help me here
make a stop
bit.
If we do something good here.
Help me here a little bit, Coach. And I've always been kind of fascinated by the mindsets and how polar opposite these two programs are. Clemson, consummate underdog. No one thinks we're good enough. How does this affect you now that Alabama has the lead and you had some adversity early in the third quarter?
Well, obviously, I get your point. But his rallying cry all year has been, you know, the play that we make.
Right.
Make sure, I think it's critical for maybe Watson to have a play or two within the series to get themselves back. I will say this. It goes to a two-score game. Now you might have a problem.
Yeah.
See, this is a play. There was nothing really here. It had to be before this.
Especially soft tissue. Yeah, soft
Booger,
tissue.
We see this so often with Alabama this year. Last year, they weren't good in this situation. But what are you sensing right now?
Well, I'm sensing from a defensive standpoint, they figured the game plan out. And they're doing a lot of twist inside, Paul. Everyone just watch the inside tackles. They're twisting inside. The ends are starting to contain. They feel like they have a pretty good grasp on Deshaun Watson right now. On the back end, the coverage is starting to tighten up just a little bit. Body blow after body blow after body blow offensively. Yeah, they got a blown coverage, but defensively, this is what Alabama always does from a defensive standpoint.
Just watch body language. I think as coaches, you're tuned into this all the time. A simple kickoff return. The brakes man, who is the opposite return man, he put the brakes on, but that ball was caught short of the numbers. That ball was coming out in the first half. They had a huge return.
Yeah.
Returned into a touchdown.
Yeah.
Now the brakes man said, hey, we're not going to do it. And the kickoff return man is pissed because he stopped him. You know, it's just bad, bad body language. But it takes just one play.
A nice job right there.
Perimeter play, bringing the wide route around.
A pretty good job by Eddie
good
Jackson.
Tempo.
It looked like there was more there.
You know,
safety for Alabama coming up, making a play. I mean, 9 yards is not what you want on first down defensively, though.
And you got to like Clemson getting the ball out of Watson's hands, trying to get him some help.
Yep.
There's Gallman. Tough run there.
Very.
Very tough run.
It's a chin strap unbuckler right
there.
Yeah, it looks like that one came loose.
To the left side. I want to tighten that thing up.
Again, the running back's behind the quarterback. He can give a fake zone or keep it.
That is unbelievable diagnosis right there.
Yeah.
I think the big thing you got to be able to do is understand, hey.
Look at Ragland. Look at him.
Feeling it. They're chomping at it. They're feeling it off their offense.
You think they're starting to feel it over there a little bit?
Yeah. I mean, you can sense it, Paul. Guys have a different bounce in their step when they come on the field because we used to always say you can smell blood in the water. And when sharks smell blood in the water, it's feeding time. And defensively, you can get the feel that Alabama says, we've got this thing a little bit under control. The quarterback is the only guy that can beat us. If we don't allow him to beat us, they're not going to beat us. And they're keying in on the quarterback right now.
Big play.
Pretty good design right there from Clemson.
Got the leverage on it.
But they keep coming back.
They do. Really, really good design. Good play call.
Really nice design. I like that concept a lot.
You think about Dabo, this is a new offensive coordinator, you know?
Yeah.
You lose an offensive coordinator and you're playing a national championship game, you're doing something right as a head coach.
And anyone that watched SMU this year realizes that Chad Morris can call some plays.
Have not seen these three plays in the first half. Those last three plays right there.
Yep, that was a design quarterback, a little fake toss. Now Watson keeps it inside.
He's feeling his mojo. Running back's way deep, coming downhill.
Play action, taking a shot.
Shot downfield.
Oh, pass interference. They get it, yeah. Didn't look back. Easy one to call.
Wonder if that was possibly uncatchable. Doesn't look like I think he had a chance at
it. Never gets called.
Very rarely.
Yeah.
You know, but guys, we talked about all year. If you're going to attack this Alabama defense, Coach, what are you attacking? On the outside, down the field.
And you go Temple, in the Power 5 conferences, Alabama is number 57 out of 65 on long balls over 20 yards completed. Yeah. I mean, that's not good, you know. So even just whether they complete it or not, you knew that Clemson was going to come in here. They're going to take 8 shots, 4 in each half, and they're going to try to either make big plays or get a call like that.
Yeah.
All of a sudden, you're on a 21.
And that's twice they've gone at Minkah Fitzpatrick. And that's twice. The touchdown early in the game, okay, where Eddie Jackson didn't get back, and then they went at him again just now. They're going, clearly, staying away from Cyrus Jones, going at Minkah Fitzpatrick when he's outside.
Wouldn't be surprised if you see him at him right here again. Second and 9, I think they've kind of said, hey, we're not going to conventionally run it right now. We can get away with some gimmicks.
Yeah.
Quarterback and running back are even. It's not going to be an inside zone.
Maybe a quarterback design run here.
Yeah, see, they just don't. Yep, they're not going to hand it to him like that. Jeez.
Wow. Yep, 4 vertical right there. That's something that they do an awful lot of if you take a look at it. Just 4 receivers, 2x2, old-fashioned. You have a safety in the middle of the field. Quarterback has to look away. Right here, look at that's actually a pretty nice
great
route.
Great play by Minkah, though. Great
fantastic play by Minkah.
Great play.
Ball's a little bit late, and he undercut it. That's a really, really nice play by the freshman.
3rd and 9. Big play. He goes empty, Coach.
He's going to 13. Wherever 13 is lined up.
13 is in the
three-man in the
three-man up in the trips up top.
13's the 3rd guy in. He's almost in the middle of the field.
Right above the 6 there.
4-man run.
1-on-1 inside. Wow.
Oh, nice. Hit.
What a great play at the end. Wow. Artavis Scott on a little inside fade route. You can't throw it any better than that.
Yeah.
I mean, that's just you just cannot throw it any better than that. You're going to see an up close.
Now, how is your kicker who just missed one right before the half?
Look at that.
Great
protection
play.
That goes with it.
Played by Harrison.
Ronnie Harrison.
Yeah, hey, that's great play.
First of all, that guy's going to be the real deal here pretty soon. He's a true freshman. Big body.
He's got his hand in there a little early.
Yeah.
That could have been called. They're letting him play a little bit. Back judge had to throw it, and he wasn't going to do it. Overloading the guard to the field again.
Mm-hmm.
Jeez, they had a personnel issue. Definitely.
Good answer.
21-17, Clemson doesn't get the touchdown that they wanted, but they put something on the board to try to stem the momentum. We'll take a break. Back to Glendale, Arizona after this.
Welcome back to Feinbaum Film Room, presented by AT&T.
Welcome back to the Film Room here with Coach Bielema, Booger, and Greg McElroy. Let's go back to the calls. Roman Harper has a big season so far with Carolina. Roman, thank you so much for the time. What do you see so far in this game?
Well, you know, I missed the first, pretty much almost the whole first half, but I was at an event earlier. I know who books an event on. You know, my guy Charles Timmons, so I'm just going to show him love. Great job tonight. It's awesome. But anyways, from what I've seen, it seems like Clemson has to do something to continue to move the pocket. They're doing a lot of misdirection, trying to slow Alabama down defensively with their eyes. It seems like they're pulling guards one way and run the ball another way. They're going to do some other things, a little screenplay as they ran. The receiver came in and cracked on Foster, and then that's how they sprung it. It's almost like a cracker place. Another way for a team to get like a sweep action, just get to the outside as fast as possible. They're just trying to do it in different ways. They can't just line up and beat Alabama, so they have to do different ways to disguise it and run around and do some other things. And that was a terrible pass interference call. I think Micah Fitzpatrick played the ball really well, especially in college's terms where you can hit receivers down the field. I thought that was a terrible call.
Bro, I got it. It's McElroy, man. I had to tell you, I liked the outfit today in the locker room during your media session. Tell everybody what you were wearing.
Hey, you know, I was laced down. I mean, we had a workout today. I had Alabama underneath my workout Carolina stuff. So I had my beanie on. I was definitely repping Greg. You'd have been proud, you know, holding it down in the locker room, man. It's not, you know, not everybody recognizes greatness when they see it when you're wearing the crimson. You should know that.
Roman Harper had a pretty big game this weekend in Carolina. Your thoughts now, Roman, though, on where this game goes from here?
You know, at the end of the day, man, I think Alabama's going to have to continue to impose their will. I think Clemson is a great team. They're going to make plays. It's not like Alabama's going to dominate. This is a very close matchup and a great, two great teams, two great coach teams as well. So Alabama has to continue to impose our will. We got to continue to make plays. Mixing up running pass, and at the end of the day, you have to contain this quarterback. Clemson's quarterback is everything. He's making the whole thing go. You have to contain this quarterback, and a turnover would really help Alabama. They need another turnover and create a short field, and now you can create the momentum and take Clemson out of their game plan of what they're trying to do.
Roman, really
that
appreciate it.
That's an Alabama fan. If you're a Clemson fan, you got to go another way. But
you got it.
I'm an Alabama guy.
Best wishes. We got best wishes Sunday. We'll all be watching. Really appreciate your time tonight.
Thanks, guys. Appreciate it.
Running the ball on first down.
You got it.
I just think here, you're putting yourself. You got a play action. I get it. You're having struggles at right tackle blocking that guy.
Yeah.
Now you're a first or a second and forever. It's tough to dig out of this hole, man.
Kevin Dodds had a pretty nice evening.
They call it having a day. He's having a day.
Oh, my goodness.
He run the ball right here. There you go.
But now they're overloading it.
Yeah.
I think these slow developing downfield throws, Jake Coker, that's what he's excelled at this year. However, with the way the offensive line is playing, particularly the right side, Taylor and Jackson, they're struggling. Dodd's having a night. They need to make sure that they either give them help along the right side or get the ball out of Jake Coker's hands a little bit faster.
Clemson has 5 sacks so far.
But, yep, they are dominating up front.
Probably screen or inside rush right here.
Got another holding call.
Yeah, you can get another holding call.
Denied.
Probably decline it. They'll punt it. Clemson will get good field position here. Now the momentum has switched back again.
This could be an alignment issue. Oh, holding.
Yeah, holding.
76, he's having a bad day.
Yeah. 76 and Pierce Barker, the left guard. The right tackle and left guard are having what we call a bad game.
This is the worst I've seen Alabama's offensive line play as a whole in quite some time. I mean, I know this is a very disruptive front. However, they've consistently gotten push, especially in the last 4 or 5 games.
Wow.
I mean, that's just getting beat inside and having the hook.
Is there a way to adjust that this late in the game?
You know, it's a mind game now as well. But I tell you what, those little guys in the orange over there, they've been hearing about Alabama's D-line. They're trying to make a statement of their own.
Yeah.
Ooh.
That was close.
They got a runner here. Set it up to the big field. Interesting thing here. Alabama has refused to go to any type of shield punt. They go old school pro. And you know, there's not very few teams that do it. They doubled their gunner up here to the right. Potentially could have got a bigger hit out of it.
You're watching the national championship here in the film room. Coach Bielema, Booger, Greg, your phone calls. We'll continue watching the second half when we return. Welcome back to the film room as we watch a very tense national championship game here. Getting your phone calls in a few minutes. The crew, Kirby Smart coaching his last game at Alabama. What are you seeing so far?
You know, it's just interesting. Paul, while I was watching that set, it looked like Nick wanted to say some things, but Kirby was acting like he wasn't even there. And it's just human nature. I mean,
sure.
He's moved on. He wants to win his game as bad as anybody, but he's got his own show, and he's trying to tell everybody what he wants to do defensively. He knows there's no consequences for him in the next game.
That's
there's
a pretty
no
good
pay raise coming. It is what it is. That's human nature, you know, and I think it's an interesting to see how this plays out here in the fourth quarter.
A lot of time left.
Oof. This is a key one, though. They got
a
good
big
field,
drive.
Good field
big
position.
Drive. Yep.
They have survived a couple of panic modes.
Yeah, a couple of situations where they've been behind and Alabama's had the ball. Their defense has gave them a couple big stops. Yeah. Now goes back on Bama's defense. Can they step up and make a big stop?
I think it's going to continue to put the big sombrero on the linebackers. Reggie Ragland and Reuben Foster need to play well at the second level.
It looks like Clemson's had a good plan for the guys up front. It's been the linebackers that have been key.
There's Watson, design run.
Again, fifth time quarterback run play on the first play of a new series.
Yep.
It's not by chance. They got some beat on them. It's statistically out there. I don't know what they're doing. That's not by chance.
Very nice design.
Yeah, 16, lead blocker there. A little token fake to Gallman. 16, the lead blocker coming around the corner there.
Every one of them has been a different play. It's just who's keeping the ball. He's going up top.
Yep.
Oh, he could have hit him in stride.
It's the same play they actually hit for a big one earlier.
Grabber.
Fake the little swing pass to the right. Bring a little wrapper around the inside. And they're getting the ball out of his hands, too, when they do try to throw it. I mean, that's a good pass rush.
Nice hit by Pettway. Yeah.
One hit like that could change the game.
That's one you remember as a quarterback. He does a good job of standing in there, though. You know, mm-hmm. I mean, think for a guy that's as mobile as he is, he does a nice job throwing it from the pocket.
I don't think he had big feelings. Big boy was there. It was on him so fast. Little man free. Number 13.
Run that back, Greg. Great one-on-one move that last play.
You love the one-on-one.
Every
time Boog taps me on a good pass rush.
Let's just take a look at this inside move here and watch this young man right here. Watch the one-on-one come upfield inside and just forces the throw just enough by Deshaun Watson. Great move inside there by Allen.
He's been absolutely
inside,
unstoppable majority of the
season. Just enough pressure inside to make him hurry that throw just a little bit.
You know what? That should have been a chip by that running back, though. Isn't he supposed to design to help chip to that side? And he wings him with an air wing.
Everybody, you're always trying to help the offensive lineman out, man. Come on. Block somebody one-on-one on your own self, coach.
I was a defensive tackle, but he's in there for a purpose, and he just air winged him. That just infuriates you. Yeah, otherwise, release him in a route. You know?
Right, exactly.
If
you're
in there, chip him.
You see a little self-inflicted wound right there from Clemson. A false start. You get in the red zone. Now you're backed up. Those things, after a big run by Watson, pretty disappointing for the Clemson fans.
Yeah, take a little ISO look at Reggie Ragland here. Something tells me the ball is going to be in Watson's hands. Let's see how Ragland identifies it here. There he goes.
Not by design, but by look at that ball security. My goodness.
Still, I mean, there's just too much. The linebackers are getting too much depth in their drop, and as a result, they can't close. It's almost as if they weren't prepared for the speed that Deshaun Watson's shown. I understand that Reggie Ragland's reading eyes. However, he's 25 yards away from Deshaun Watson when he exits the pocket, and I don't care if he runs 4.8, he's going to have a hard time catching him.
Guys, think about this. Nick Saban has been in Alabama a long time. Never has Nick Saban had an opposing quarterback, rush for 100 yards against him. Watson has got to be getting close tonight, close to 100 yards rushing.
I remember in 2012, Johnny Manziel had about 90 in the first 4 seconds.
It looks like he's taking it well.
Watson's got 86 yards, guys.
But he's looking a little bit Manziel-esque.
Well, I mean, he's just taking the game in his own hands. And we said it. The one way Clemson can win this football game if Watson has a Vince Young type performance. So far tonight, he's having one.
Right now, Allen needs to take a look at how far across the ball he is. Just to make sure when he gets back.
There's pressure coming. Fitzpatrick, one on one. You got to make a tackle on the open field.
Pretty good tackle, rally up. Didn't make it on his own, but took his chance at it and let his teammates come in for the assist.
Ball's on the four.
Nine. For the record, Coach Bielema really liked Clemson tonight.
What's that?
He really liked Clemson before the game.
Now, don't get me in trouble.
Yeah, you keep saying that.
I had confidence said that. I thought they'd play okay.
Said they would play well. They are.
There's just something about being told you can't do something
Yeah.
for as long. And, you know, I saw some commentary before the game where Somebody spent some, I think it was Tim Tebow was saying,
already
spent a lot of time with him yesterday, and Dabble was overplaying it. Well, it works.
Watch a little muddle huddle right here. Maybe a pitch to the right now. They're going to have to call a timeout.
Coach, speak to that, because your first couple of years in the SEC.
Well, we didn't have a choice. We were always the underdog. But we're getting there now, you know. And
right.
It has to do with the attitude, the approach, the demeanor. When you're the favorite, you can't do anything about it. You're the favorite. You want guys to play
right.
Well. You got that added little influence of being the underdog, I think.
Yeah, but all we heard about this, there's a brotherhood at Alabama, and they're the best.
I tell you what Dabble has done, in my opinion, he's an unbelievable recruiter. He's a great motivator. He does things in his own way. But he gets a lot of really good players, that love football.
Right.
You know, and that's the kind of guys you can put into this type of situation.
Maybe just something to note here. Gallman getting looked at and evaluated on the sideline. Looked a little awkward as he was getting tackled on that last one. So the starting running back for Clemson also getting checked out. Favoring
Deshaun Watson's right responsible for 302 of Clemson's 325 yards so far.
He is three times more productive than any other quarterback Alabama has faced this year in point totals. That stat speaks volumes, I think. A lot of different things out there, but again, only three quarterbacks in the history of college football to rush for 1,000 and throw for 3,500, and the other one is Johnny Manziel, and we know what Johnny Manziel did to Alabama in 2012. Yeah. It was their only loss, you know, so the best indicator of what's going to happen in the future is what's happened in the past.
And Johnny's defense wasn't playing as well as Clemson's defense is playing right now. So, you know, I think that Alabama needs to figure out a way to try to force three here. Obviously, that's going to be very difficult given the situation
victory,
on the field. But I think that
it'd
would
be a huge victory.
A huge moral victory forcing a field goal here after what's been a really nice drive from Clemson.
Be a very, very huge victory. Interesting to see what they do right now. Normally, when Clemson gets down to the goal line, put the ball in your quarterback's hands. A quarterback, I wouldn't be surprised
runs,
to see a quarterback design run here, quarterback power, quarterback draw. Why take it out of the guy's hands when he's having a night? I think that's what you're going to see here from Clemson.
Yeah, I think quarterback counter is the one that they ran earlier at the top of the red zone. Didn't have a ton of success with it, but I bet that's the call here if we see the formation, see what they might be going with.
Oh, yeah, he buckled it right there.
Yeah.
Yeah, but he's back on the field. Shouldn't hold him up too much. Maybe just a little tweak.
I didn't do anything. 13. I'd find out where 13 is. 44. That's the first time we've seen him in the game, isn't it? The fullback.
Yeah.
A little counter.
Quarterback keep
design
it.
Run.
Quarterback. Great counter play by Reggie Ragland.
Really nice play. That looked like it was going to be a walk-in there for a second. Reggie Ragland closed in a hurry.
Well, he definitely made a great play. If you're Clemson, come right back to it.
Well, I tell you what, just a play call in the second half for Clemson.
Let's listen to Eli Gold, the Alabama play-by-play announcer.
I don't think he's going to like it.
Snap. The give. The fight by Gallman back to the line of scrimmage. Nothing more. That time, Alabama went underneath and over the top with Sean Dion Hamilton and Reggie Ragland.
Well, Alabama won a national championship back in the 1979 Sugar Bowl. Our good friend Barry Krause went over the top, turned away Mike Gooman. Alabama's got to dig in and do it again here. Third down, perhaps even four down territory for Dabo Swinney.
Ryan Anderson checks in. Backs are in the pro set eye. Third and goal from a yard away. Here's the give. They push the pile, and he is in. Gallman, touchdown.
Well, Alabama tried to build a wall, but Gallman is a very aggressive, relentless runner. He nudges it over the goal line, and Clemson.
Yeah, I've been watching the body language between Nick and Kirby Smart. You are absolutely right, Coach. They are barely speaking right now.
It's a different environment. I've had two coordinators have gone on to be head coaches. Both of them were in the Rose Bowl, and I love them to death. Would do anything for me, but it was different.
Yeah.
It's just different. You don't work together anymore. It's a different way of looking at it. And when adversity strikes, there's just not that same rallying cry. It's one of those things. There's nothing you can do about it. And it's just human nature.
Something very, very rare that you see right there is Jaron Reed getting pushed off the football. He's actually a yard deep in the end zone as Gallman crosses the plane. So They're not winning up front. I mean, Alabama, that is where they've prided themselves, and they have not won up front this tonight. I think that they've underestimated the speed of Deshaun Watson, and they also underestimated the talent and the skill along the offensive line, because I was surprised to see them pushing around and imposing their will as much as they are.
Yeah.
You know, it would be a great question in the post game, regardless of what happens here. Ask Alabama who simulated Deshaun Watson in scout team prep. I didn't read about it. I didn't follow it as much as everybody in this room, but it'd be interesting, you know, to figure out who was simulating that guy and if it was someone of his caliber or not.
There's very few of his caliber, so I don't know.
But even in the ballpark,
sure,
you know, not the guys that Alabama recruits, the quarterback. If they're a scout team quarterback that they have recruited, you know, and which I'm sure has five stars and all that jazz, but regardless if he's much like that cat right there. What's ironic about that play, that's a very much Alabama play.
I was just going to say that.
That's not a Clemson play.
The fullback Williams, they just lined up in a traditional I formation. The fullback Williams hit Reggie Ragland in the mouth and buckled it, okay? That's physicality. I didn't expect to see that from Clemson.
Yeah.
We saw the fullback last in the Cotton Bowl for Michigan State. Reggie Ragland was ragdolling that guy. 44 from Clemson, just hit Ragland in the mouth and buckled him.
The kicker's got some pretty shoes, doesn't he?
Got some yellow tips on the shoes. That was another thing, too. I mean, Clemson goes under center only 25 times prior to that last snap.
Yeah.
So you don't see him under center very often. So another thing that was a little bit of a changeup right there from the Tigers on the goal line.
Got a runner. Got a runner. It's coming back to the field.
Punch, counterpunch. Yeah, okay, so, you know, Clemson fought back. Now what does Jay Coke and Alabama do?
There's one thing there with an indicator. The very only time that Alabama's fullback comes back to the field on their kickoff return is when it's come back to the field. Well scouted by Clemson, and they pin him inside of 20. The chances of you scoring now go below 75% when you start inside of 20. So great, great numbers on Clemson's side right here. So as a defense coordinator, I'd always say, now play the numbers, you know. Be successful on what your best calls are. Don't take chances. You're playing behind the numbers right here.
Lane Kiffin is going to do what, Greg?
He's got to start running the football. I mean, at this point, every slow developing drops resulted in negativity for Alabama. They've had one throw down the field that was successful. That was to Mullaney. They need to get in the pistol, which they're in right now. And they need to try to run the ball between the tackles.
Clemson has 331 yards, third highest so far. The game's not over yet.
Yeah. But you know what?
Is that rush? How much rushing?
It's second down and 7. And to me, this is a big down. Because if you're committed to the run, run it again on second down.
Sure.
Okay, don't feel like this is a passing down. It's second and 7. Run it again.
And they've just brought in Brandon Green, the big tight end slash tackle that we talked about earlier. Gave up the sack. He's lined up on the left-hand side. But he's a guy that's been pretty good when trying to seal the edge. Short motion, you might take a shot right here.
Quick, easy
nice
throw.
Play call. Nice
very,
play
very
call.
Good.
Nice play call.
Hang on that ball, boy.
It's very nice. Very nice right there. Get Jake Coker back on track. Move the pocket a little bit, understanding that this is a very aggressive front.
Gave the illusion of run. Heavy run formation. We all thinking
heavy
run.
Heavy personnel.
Heavy personnel. Yes. Everything they're screaming out. Hey, we're running. We're running. Little play action. Nice deception there by Lane Kiffin.
Look how far Alabama's off the ball. This is a play action. Nope.
There's not much push. You see a lot of Alabama offensive linemen on the ground.
You guys see a lot more of them every week than I do. Aren't they really off the ball?
What are we seeing out of Derrick Henry? Let's not to even take the 50-yard run out. But
I'd give a lot of credit to the guys in orange, to be quite honest. I doubt very much that Alabama was ill-prepared. I think it's I give a lot of credit to Brent Venables. The guy there has been a great coordinator. Why he hasn't been a head coach blows my mind. One of the great minds in our game.
And Greg pointed out earlier, Clemson's defensive line is doing a good job. They're whooping Alabama's offensive line up front besides the Cam Robinson matchup. I think he's winning his matchup. But the other guys up front, Ryan Kelly, Pierce Bakker, Jackson, those guys are not playing their best tonight.
Two plays right now, two throws from Jake Coker. Both came out a little bit low. Howard was able to catch it. This one hits the ground before our Darius Stewart can catch it. He's gripping it a little bit tight, feeling the effects a little bit. They're trying to get him out of the pocket, make him feel comfortable. But 3rd and 9 is not a situation in which Alabama's been successful this season. One of the worst teams in the country on 3rd down, particularly 3rd and long.
Place is rocking if you're in orange.
3rd and 9, they got the perfect substitution. Got the right call.
Bringing pressure.
Pressure to the weak side.
Little zone blitz.
Ball's out.
It's a good throw right there, though. Mulaney's got to finish that.
Let's run that back, Greg, a little bit, guys. And here's what we mean by when we talk about a zone blitz. They're going to drop. They're going to take Shaq Lawson, drop him out. Take a look at him. Here's Shaq Lawson right here, bottom of the screen. They're going to take him, drop him out in the coverage. They're going to bring the blitz from the side over there. So it's an interesting look here in the zone blitz concept. Shaq Lawson drops out there. But blitz coming.
I mean, look at the top right here. He's coming
still
right
back. Still a man-free blitz, but yeah, they're bringing some guys into droppers.
Yeah.
And, Coach, it was a freshman quarterback who just reported, who simulated Deshaun Watson, and obviously not very well.
Yeah.
Who was it, didn't know? That's right.
And right there, I mean, Alabama can look at that and say, look, we stopped ourselves right there. We had a chance on third down and 9.
Yeah.
Dropped the football. Mulaney, senior player, guy that you depend on, has done a nice job on third down for a majority of the year and in the red zone. One of your more dependable guys, obviously fighting it a little bit. It's a big stop right there, big series right here for Alabama.
How great
defense.
This Alabama defense is.
Biggest drive of the season from
right here. Right now.
It is on the line right now. Big drive.
Here comes pressure.
Here comes Watson with the ball. He pitches it. Minka Fitzpatrick running the alley.
That's a pretty good job by Clemson. I mean, they've been a nice job of mixing sideline up in the middle, quarterback run. It's a lot of different variations. I didn't see this much variation over the course of the regular season.
Again, I think never saw a down the line option in the first half. The play calling by Clemson in the second half has really been very, very unique. We haven't seen anything.
Exactly.
There's a miss. Repeat plays.
There's a missed throw by Watson there. One of the rare missed throws of him throwing on the run there. Guy was pretty much wide open.
Paul, this score holds up. What's the nation's reaction to Alabama?
I think, as you said earlier, it's going to be a lot about Deshaun Watson and Clemson. And
yeah, look at he knew he missed that one.
You'll hear some sniping about what Coach said in relation to Kirby Smart, and maybe it finally got to the Alabama staff.
Okay, here they come.
They're changing
the call. He saw Reuben Foster come. Deshaun Watson checked the protection. They changed the play.
And keep in mind,
now they also circle that. Alabama changed their defense, too.
Yeah.
Alabama had a pressure. They audibled.
Yep.
Alabama then changed. This is a great coaching thing. So Alabama changed because they thought they were bringing pressure. Kirby changed, didn't bring pressure, dropped him in the zone, but the quarterback did a nice job. Receiver did a nice job of getting inside their defender.
Yeah, Leggett, one of the best tight ends in the country. So definitely a safety blanket for Deshaun Watson.
Quick sweep.
Throwing the football.
Boy, got a safe play.
Let's see how fast Clemson's going to try to attack right here. Not overwhelming tempo right now.
Right now.
They did it in the first quarter, I think, just to get their gas.
Sure.
Win them a little bit.
Get going.
Wouldn't mad be surprised if you see a QB run game here. Quarterback, running back even. It's not a downhill zone necessarily.
Quarterback.
Little roll right.
Throwback.
Back wheel.
Throwback.
He's got him. Oh, he grabbed him.
Don't throw it.
Throw it out of bounds.
Can't throw out of bounds, you're right. A couple of times they've tried to isolate Reuben Foster and Reggie Ragland one-on-one matchups. Those guys are great linebackers athletically coming downhill, but I think they can be very susceptible to the pass when you put them in pass coverage.
I think you want to see this real quick if you want to take a peek at it. Take a peek at what's going on right here. A little throwback. Nothing crazy. Fake it. Rolling it around to the right. Just a good job recovering by Reuben Foster, and we'll check out this third down and 8.
Big play. Somebody has to go get him. Great play by Foster coming up.
Oh,
contained.
Low range, everything.
Yes.
Big play.
That was a long time coming.
Well, that was a championship type saving drive because Clemson had the momentum. And we talked about this Alabama defense, but what did they do? They kept the quarterback from turning the corner on the edge, coming up on the outside.
And finally, they were able to get home. You know, I mean, they've been doing as much as they possibly could. And Deshaun Watson's dynamic.
You're right.
Really, really dynamic with
the
football.
They got him spying the quarterback for a reason. One of very few guys that can get him
done. It felt like the game was on the brink right there before that play.
Great play by Rashawn Evans. As you said, Coach, spying the quarterback, getting somebody with speed and athleticism to spy the quarterback where they can go and make a tackle in the open field.
Man, this punter is phenomenal.
He's done a nice job.
He reads where the returner, and then he decides where he's going to kick it.
And that mistake by Cyrus Jones cost him about 20 yards.
Yeah, not being able to field it.
Yeah.
I mean, if you look at it, though, I mean, it's really, really tough to catch the ball on a short hop. I know I played third base in baseball.
100%.
You catch one of those short hops, man, it's tough to pick it up. And
right.
Honestly, I would rather for Cyrus Jones to err on the side of what he just did.
Yeah.
Let it roll.
Right.
You know, unfortunately, it's going to land inside the five for the Tide, but it's not a fumble, and it's not giving them new life.
Right, but I did think he could come and take it out the air. I mean, it's not like that ball had a lot of heat on it. Go up, and I think you saw his body reaction there. It's like, man, I should have caught that in the air.
Think about where that punter was. Remember when he ran the fake punt? He wasn't supposed to run it, ran the wrong
right,
key.
Right, man, absolutely.
People could have jumped him, dabbled, and that staff picked him up, and now he's had two critical plays.
One thing I've noticed, too, that I think Clemson's done a really good job of is tackling. I mean, mm-hmm. Derrick Henry's a big back. He's not a guy that usually goes down on first contact, but I haven't seen him breaking a lot of tackles. Even the 50-yard run was the product of being untouched and really well blocked up along the offensive line. They've tackled well in the secondary and at the second level.
Minus two key players. One player for sure, the whole second half.
Clemson is ready right now.
They're getting up quick.
For a jet sweep.
What do you think, Coach? Third and short.
I think he's going to put the ball in the air. We got a fourth quarter.
Yep.
I'm thinking a jet sweep right here. They have not really accounted for the jet sweep to
Darius Stewart.
We'll take
a short break. We'll be back with the film room and the fourth quarter after this.
Welcome back to the Feinbaum Film Room. As you can see, a big third down for Alabama. Sails just a little bit wide.
Jay Coker's been off tonight, guys. He has been off tonight. That Calvin really runs a nice little route. Ball's got to be out right there. He threw it 5 to 7 yards too far outside.
Looked like it fluttered out of his hand a little bit.
It didn't come out real clean.
You know, I would expect Clemson to set up a nice return here. They're going to get good field position. Don't want to do anything rough on the punter. I bet you they'll have a nice little 8-man hold up. Gonna let this guy see what he can do. Got a double gunner to the left. My guess is there's a field returner coming to our to Clemson's left.
J.K. Scott's the type of guy that can
change a straight hold up.
Change a little momentum right.
Watch to the field. Get to the field. He's got a chance. Do a nice job of pinning him over the boundary.
Now, if you're Clemson right here, Coach, 50-yard line. You got a lot of momentum. It might be time for a shot.
It might be a shot. You know, they got a PI, a defensive pass interference before. Maybe not on first down, but second down, I think everybody would be talking about it. Alabama's so well coached, they're going to be saying, hey, they're going to take a shot. They're going to take a shot. Maybe first down and second down, they forget about it a little bit.
Here we always spent the entire week talking about Nick Saban on the threshold of perhaps becoming the greatest coach of all time, and now he is behind in trouble here in the fourth quarter.
Well, and his defense is on the field again. You guys talking about a shot. For everyone that's listening who may not know what a shot is, let's just take a shot at a touchdown. Throwing the football.
Unlike half of our callers. A few shots tonight.
Throw the football deep down the field. Try to get a touchdown in a single play or two. But, Paul, we've talked about the strength of this Alabama team all year. It's the defense. Well, once again, they're on the field. If they give up two first downs here, they're in field goal range. Okay, so the defense has to buckle down. I'm very interested. This could be the game here. If you're Dabo, you got to coach like you must get points on this drive. And if you're Nick and Kirby, you have to coach like, hey, if we allow points the way our quarterback is playing, which is not good right now, we're in trouble.
Fellas, it's the beginning of the fourth quarter. It's a four-point game.
I'll say.
Right? I mean, as much as we want to say whether Nick won or lost his game, he's one of the greatest it's ever been.
Right.
The flip side, the guys in orange are playing their tails off.
Coach, but we sat here last year and watched this Ohio State game. Alabama was up 21-6.
Yeah.
Slipped away. This isn't identical, but a totally different situation. But it feels very awkward and similar to that one.
You know, one thing that also needs to be mentioned here, Clemson has not trailed in the fourth quarter this year. Haven't trailed in the fourth quarter in 17 games. So if, in fact, Alabama is able to get a stop, get a score, take the lead, how will Clemson respond to the adversity? And now, conversely, they playing with the lead, how aggressive do they become, even though their offense is playing pretty good against a very good defense? But I think this is a time, if you're offensive coordinator for Clemson, Jeff Scott, Coach Elliott, Tony Elliott, throwing it down the field, giving Sherron Peak or Artavis Scott a shot on a post route, see if you can't make a big play right here to start the fourth quarter off right offensively.
You know, and any time, Coach, you get in big-time situations, your big-time players have to step up.
Huge.
We've talked about this Alabama defensive line, Robinson, Allen, Jaren Reed. I haven't heard much from those guys tonight. Allen made a couple good one-on-one moves. This defensive line needs to step up and make some big game-changing plays here. There's Artavis Scott on the outside.
And they're really running it well. You know, I mean, I think inside, outside, right, left.
If I could get somebody to tell me how many yards they rushed for, I know I'm the new kid on the block, but I would love to know Clemson's rush total. It's got to be getting close to that magic number.
It's more than what Alabama usually gives up, I assure you.
Okay, Clemson has rushed for 200 yards 11 times this year already. The last three teams to rush for 200 yards against Alabama have all won. That's not going to help you.
Almost a critical mistake right there.
Yeah. Still going to be third and short, though. Or second and short, should I say.
No, it's second down.
Looked like he wasn't sure.
First down.
Jake Coker had a similar play earlier where he had a little swing route or a bubble route. Got a little indecisive to Deshaun Watson right there. Tried to hand it late. Couldn't get it into the belly of the back.
Another design run.
Paul, some nerves, you think, from Phyllis and some of the other Alabama
fans? I think right now Alabama fans, they know it's a three-point game, Coach, but they feel like they've seen this movie before, and they were told by so many people beforehand it wasn't going to happen. They're nervous.
I tell you, that I would bet a lot of money that the ones that aren't nervous are the ones that matter.
Right.
That is correct.
They've been in this before. They've been in this year already, even regardless of what's happening right here.
Huge down right here, though, on third and 10.
Zone pressure.
Boy, they brought him. They definitely brought him.
Nice play. Nice play by Humphrey there.
That was maybe a game-saving play.
Alabama went small there. No A'shaun Robinson on the field, no Reggie Ragland.
Interesting. And it was a tempo. They huddled, so they were allowed to get that out there.
Yeah. Two of their better players, also two of their bigger players they took off the field. Interesting little sub-package.
Coach, I'll ask you again, and you know, Kirby Smart was part of the team when they shut Michigan State out, but there has to be some Alabama fans wondering about this last week and a half or 2 weeks as he's shuttled back and forth.
It's just human reaction. Again, you know, I think it's going to naturally come up where they can get, big break there.
Yeah,
very
huge.
Big break.
Huge.
Very big break.
Very, very poor execution right there. Just by those guys not getting their heels to the goal line.
Coach, I want to ask you right now. You've seen this entire game. You've seen Jay Coker. You've seen how rattled he's been. It's the fourth quarter, the college football playoff title game. I know you said you don't talk to the offensive coordinator.
Right,
right now, in the fourth quarter, are you saying something to your OC, Coach? Let's get to this. Let's get to that. What are you saying right now, having seen the first three quarters?
In the fourth quarter break, I might remind him that we do have a lead in certain situations to – conserve on the ability to make us run the football, eat the clock. We go into a little situation where we might milk the clock, but not with just three score, not with three-point game. But if it gets to seven or more, it would definitely show up.
And explain to me this. I think, honestly, aside from the 50-yard touchdown run, which was a little bit of a blown assignment defensively and a well-blocked, well-executed play, nice cutback, why haven't we seen that stretch play right where they got so much push on the edge by
two
Alabama?
Plays in a row?
I want to see that play. That play hasn't really come up. We saw it once. I want to see him stretch the right side of the offensive line. Dominic Jackson, for as much struggle as he had, the right tackle, pass blocking, he's still a dominant run threat. Try to run behind him.
Coach, we've seen a lot of injuries on the Clemson side. What effect are those injuries going to have now?
Well, it hasn't been to this point. I got to believe those guys that have stepped in are going to keep battling. They're riding the mojo of being up by three. They're excited. They're in a point where no one said they would. I'm excited to see these next few series. I would say this, though. Alabama,
Just stay with what got you here.
Derrick Henry has been held to 21 yards on 7 carries in the second half.
And, you know, he's only averaging 3.7, I believe, statistically in the first half if you take out the 50-yard run. So sustainable success has not necessarily been all the time for Alabama.
We'll grab a quick call here. John is in Oklahoma. John, good evening. Welcome to our show.
Hey, how's it going?
Very well. What can we do for you?
Well, I had a question for Coach. You know, I'm a big Razorback fan, and we played some here recently, played a close game with Alabama. But, you know, it's a different game when it comes down to the fourth quarter. What's Clemson going to have to do to pull it out? Like, what are they going to have to do to win a national championship tonight?
Good question. Thank you, John. Appreciate it.
I think without a doubt Clemson's got to be able to do what they've done in the first three quarters, stick to their plan, don't look back, don't flinch. What we failed to do was continue to do the things that brought us success in the first half. We got a little bit inconsistent on first and second down, which put us in bad positions on third down. So stick to their guns. Don't go conservative here. They've had a very creative play call here in the third quarter. I hope he continues through the fourth.
All right, and look at this. We get a little shift to the right. Will we see this stretch play perhaps, Book?
Yeah, I would.
Same alignment.
The naked once again.
Yep.
He's got the comeback. There it is. Well thrown.
Big chunk.
Well, big chunk. And you know, Jay Coker, I mean, he hasn't played terrible, but he's just missed a lot of open throws tonight. I mean, he's playing very, very average.
He hasn't seemed comfortable at all.
Yeah, I mean, just kind of very fidgety.
Are we up to 5 sacks or 6?
It's going to be a stretch.
That's a big number.
Stretch to the right right here.
Yeah, if he stretches right, he's probably going to cut it back left.
There it is.
He's always looking to cut it back, though.
Did we talk about the stretch play?
Yeah,
they've shown it once?
Yep.
I think that's a play that's got to be important to him. Get flow going then cut it north and south. Right there was well played.
Yeah.
Well executed defensively by the Clemson defense. I think you have to continue to push the ball into Derrick Henry's belly and allow him to run right behind Alphonse Taylor and Dom Jackson along the right-hand side.
They're still running it.
Derrick Henry trying to bounce it out. That's something he shouldn't do, though. I mean, he's a guy who wants to take it downhill.
Well,
trying to bounce it outside there, Coach, probably not a good idea.
Well, you know, he lines up in a full yard depth behind it. The only play this play is supposed to go is downhill. This, with that type of depth in his alignment, he should be not going east and west.
Yeah.
And once again, Clemson cornerback, this time Condre Tankersley, making a tackle in the backfield against a 245-pound running back. That's not something that we've seen over the course of the regular season. Tight set right here.
Quarterback, running back even. Protection. Always got a short arm.
Oh,
wow. What a throw.
Wow. What a throw. What a catch.
That is answered.
What a catch.
You know what? That's the throw that changes everything right there. This is actually a play that a lot of people remember from our first film room, Paul. They ran this exact same play for a touchdown to Amari Cooper against Auburn last year. A little tight set, show the corner, and release vertical.
And Alabama fans slowly backing up from the bridge.
I don't think they were ever at the bridge, Paul. I just think they get a little nervous sometimes.
They get nervous when they're not up by 38 points.
Yeah, I get that. I get that. Derrick Henry, though, you expect a big dose of Derrick Henry.
I mean, that I can't get over the throw right there.
You
know
what? Third and 11.
I think you got to give Jay Coker credit. He hasn't made many throws tonight like that, and he made a great one there. One-on-one coverage, top of the field.
This is where the corner's missed. Going to pick on him. That's McKenzie's backup, right?
Yeah.
That's Adrian Baker. That is McKenzie's backup. Yeah. Pretty well played. Pretty big body, long arms. Runs better than people would realize. Well thrown right there, though. Giving his guy a chance.
And let him play there a little bit.
Eli Gold will pick up here on the third down.
A sack there.
Bama 7 of 15 in third down conversions.
Bama's got the field goal in their pocket here. Got to be judicious with the ball at third and 7.
Bama missed a field goal earlier. Here's the snap to Coker now. Jake looks. Jake fires. It's across the middle, incomplete. Ardarius Stewart looking for the football at the 2 in triple coverage. Could not get to it. And the Crimson Tide now bringing in the field goal unit to try and tie the ball game.
Well, that was a risky throw there by Jake Coker, but at 6'5", he overshot everybody, and now Adam Griffith on to tie this one up at 24 apiece.
It'll be a 34-yard field goal try. From this distance this year, he is 4 of 6. He missed from 45 earlier. This is from 34. Heading towards the end zone to our right. Snap and spot are good. Kick is on the way. It is up and it is good. And we are all tied up.
Game is tied after a lot of anxiety, Coach. That's why you're a coach and we're commentators. You were calm. We were on the edge of our seat.
Well, I tell you what, big time catch and throw. We had a critical moment on 3rd and 11, but it's one of those games. Who's going to have the football last? Who's going to come out on top?
And let's take a look at that throw, that long pass by Jake Coker. It's the exact same play. It's called a circle 7 and go. All right, so I want you to see Ardarius Stewart. He's right here in the slot in the bunch alignment. You're going to see O.J. Howard right here release on an out. You're going to see him come up, release out, and then release vertical. As a result, the safety breaks as though he thinks it's going to be a corner route. Really, really well executed. It puts big-time stress on the field. And with Jay Coker's big arm talent, he's able to throw it off his back foot, which very few quarterbacks can do, and still deliver an accurate ball in stride. Yeah. Very well executed. Nice play call, especially when you look at what they were doing defensively.
Right.
You talk about a game of inches. That almost went off the shoulder.
It is amazing.
I mean, it was an inch at most. But, again, enough confidence for him to step up and throw it. Great play call. Great execution. Tell you what, everybody's kind of holding their breath on those field goals, though.
Well, yeah. I mean.
Oh, yeah.
It wasn't a gimme.
Bama's missed one. Clemson had one block. Anytime you get college kickers out there, Coach.
What do you mean? Easy on the kickers, my man.
Come on. Anytime you get the young college kickers out there, you don't know what to expect.
I'll be honest with you, they do make me nervous from time to time.
They do.
Let's bring in Evan in Oxford, Mississippi, as we'll see what folks are saying out there in the country. Hey, Evan, good evening.
Hey, Paul, how are you?
We're doing great. Thanks for the call.
I have a question for Coach Bielema.
What's up, Evan?
I go to Ole Miss, and I was just wondering if anybody from Tuscaloosa has thanked you after the game in Oxford. You broke my heart and pulled off the upset.
Evan, so let me interrupt you. I thanked him earlier.
Well, Evan, I didn't mean to give you any hard egg, but I also enjoyed the win myself. So I have been well received by the Alabama fans.
We have the hand on the button tonight. In case you do one of those, I have to hop on the plane.
We don't need one of those.
You've been on the other end of those, too. Those things, it's crazy, man. It's just college football. There's nothing quite like it.
What a great environment. Great. You know, everything about that play should stand in memory for a long time.
Was it a crazier finish than the Miami-Duke game? I think both of those two
games. It was because our game was legal. Theirs was illegal.
David is in Little Rock. A lot of Woo Pig calls tonight for the coach. Go right ahead, David.
That's right, Woo Pig. Hey, Coach, put us in the headsets, both sides of the field. What are you listening to? How much is listen versus lead? Are you listening to the booth? Are you listening to your assistants? Put us on both sides. What's going on in their heads right now? How they're trying to focus as a head coach? Thanks a lot.
Without a doubt, I think.
Thanks, David.
Holy cow.
Little pooch. Look at this.
This is well designed. So you have a situation here that the Clemson on film has shown that their left tackle has been leaving early. So basically what they did is put a pooch situation in here.
Wow.
Clemson turned their back and ran the other way.
Coach, let's talk about this. What in the world did we just see here?
I think Dabo's saying that they were offsides. A lot of times in these situations, the kicker decelerates right before he hits the kick. Watch this. You're going to have the guy at the top right. Oh, no, they're all on sides.
This ain't North Carolina, all right? You can watch this right here. There's room along the sideline. I want you to take a peek at this. But the reason why, look at where the widest kickoff player is for Alabama.
Yeah.
They're only as wide as the widest. That's really well done.
Coach.
Getting out to the sideline and a very nicely executed little chip shot right there by Adam Griffith.
This is a kickoff formation that's really become popular the last 3 years. Everybody
Coach, game tied in the national championship.
Big.
I mean, have you ever seen anything
that
like
this? Gigantic. That is, you know what? That's big.
That play.
Oh.
And that's not reviewable as far as the guy being offsides, is it, Coach?
No, it's not.
Exactly.
No.
What would possess you to make that call?
Well, they'd seen it on film repeatedly, I'm assuming.
Look at the accuracy, though. I mean,
rehearse that kick. Every kicker does that.
Yeah.
You know, everybody has this in the.
But, I mean, we're talking about it just for a second. If that kick works, Alabama wins. We're talking about a national championship and a possible elevation of Nick Saban to an exalted status. I mean, we're talking about something that is just unbelievable.
That's probably one of the biggest calls I've ever
witnessed. But if you think about this, why can't he do that? Because he's got confidence in his defense.
Right, exactly.
Okay, because if he doesn't get that, now he's got confidence he can put his defense back on the field.
I'm telling you, I don't know if I've ever seen a call like that.
No, I'm with you.
Right here, Alabama would normally take a shot. They're probably checking it right here. Look at how deep the safeties are for Clemson.
Look at the coverage they have up top. Calvin Ridley one-on-one. I don't even see a safety in the screen.
They're going to run the play.
Yeah.
I mean, guys, I've covered college football longer than most of you were alive. I have never seen anything with so much importance on the line to make a call like that Nick Saban just did.
Well, you know, but Paul, that's scouting. That's confidence in your special teams coach who says, hey, I see something, coach. You got to trust your coaches. You hire these coaches and pay them for a reason. You got to trust
them. How often have you made a call like that in the fourth quarter with a game tie?
That would be zero. I called a fake punt to win my first Big Ten championship on our own 25-yard line, which was unique. But there was something else very unique. Nick Saban smiled after that play.
Yeah, he did, because he knew he got away with one, I think.
I thought that's what you were
talking about. Kenyon Drake up the sideline. Wow.
Can you say the pendulum has swung?
I think we've found our play of the game up to this point.
And it's a kicker. You guys were just bashing him. You guys were just beating him up.
Booger was beating him. I was defending him.
Hey, college kickers, hard to trust him.
Want to know what's really amazing about this? This is the exact same thing that they did against Michigan State, hitting O.J. Howard down the left-hand sideline on a little circus 7-and-go. The exact same thing. You watch him. He's going to release up vertical and then over the top. Unexpected playmakers. Alabama has had to rely on O.J. Howard not once but twice tonight to make long touchdown plays. Someone always steps up, Booger, when it comes to the national championship.
Hey, we talk about O.J. Howard all
Where's
the time.
Where's he been? Where's he been?
Exactly.
He's over 100, almost 150 yards receiving tonight, Paul. That's almost 150 yards receiving for O.J. Howard. And we wondered all year, does Alabama even know where the tight end is? He's coming up big tonight.
You know, that was just such an unbelievable turn of events. That play call in the special teams game, and look, you got to win all three phases.
Right.
That was impressive.
About Nick Saban may have lost a three-peat on a special teams debacle, and he may have won one right there.
Can I say something? You don't make that call unless you know it's going to work. There is nobody on that side of the field.
Yeah.
The chances of them not getting it are probably 90-10. Because of the execution they've seen in the game.
Listen, it may go down as one of the greatest calls of all time, and it doesn't matter now, but just for the sake of argument, what if it hadn't worked?
Well, if that call doesn't work, he puts his defense back on the field. Because he's got confidence in his defense, it doesn't matter if it works or not.
Pure confidence.
I'm going to put my defense back on the field because I know they can stand up.
I think there's nobody outside of the hash.
Yeah.
I mean, there's nobody there. I love it. It's a great, but there's nobody there.
Where do you think he saw that, and when did he make that decision?
Well, that formation has become very, like I said, very common in the last 3 or 4 years. To be quite honest, one of the first I saw do it was Urban Meyer at Ohio State, where they load everybody to that side. So it's been something that's growing, and they've probably seen a couple teams line up like that and saw the look they got and were waiting to get it.
I'll say this. I think a lot of people, most kickers, probably because they have a lot of time, are pretty good golfers.
Yeah.
You know, it's a similar
Chip
movement
shot.
The way things go. That is like hitting a wedge perfect to within 3 feet, though. I think people
something
need to
something
realize.
Something you've never done, by the way.
Not a lot of people have kicked. I haven't. I can tell you that much.
For the guy to catch it, though. But the guy, yes. that guy didn't yeah. catch it. There's nobody over there.
Right.
I mean, there's nobody there. I mean, it's
yeah.
I think if you really put things into perspective right there. Yeah, of course, you have to assume you're not going to call unless you think it's going to work. But, man, that is
Clemson down for the first time in the fourth quarter all year.
First time in the fourth quarter in 17 games, not just the 14 they played this year.
Yeah.
First time they've trailed since, I believe, the Georgia Tech game a year ago.
And now, if you're Deshaun Watson, this game has been on his back
yeah.
all night. There is no run game working. There's no Gallman. Everything is on Watson. Now we're going to find out, can he step up? Here's a guy that finished third in the Heisman Trophy voting. They're going to put the game on him right now. Can he step up? Can he handle it? I think Nick Saban likes where he's at right now, Coach.
Just for fun, you think he'll do it again?
No. There's the answer to that. He kicked the deep right there.
We'll grab a quick call here. A good friend of mine in Birmingham. Bobby, how you feeling, my man?
Well, my ass so tight, Paul, it cut off a 10-penny nail. Y'all doing a good
Hey, thank you, Bobby.
You guys y'all take doing a good job, Bobby. Bro. I want you to take a peek.
Okay. Thanks for the call, Bobby. We'll talk later.
Bobby, watch this. Look at how Clemson lined up this time. All right, last time, this wide guy right here, the tackle on kickoff, was lined up on the hash. This time, just a little bit wider, even though when you look at the Alabama team, they're lined up the exact same. Fool me once, shame on me. Fool me twice, shame on you.
Yeah. Oh, boy.
Just like that, Clemson at the 50-yard line.
Deshaun Watson answered.
That one right there, a G-bot. Get back on track play. G-bot.
What a great game. Don't lose sight of how awesome this is right now. Two teams playing their heart out. Coach is not leaving anything in the playbook.
Yeah.
Oh, boy.
The first time you've seen Gallman break free tonight.
What is going on here, Coach?
Two big plays. Both middle field safety open. That was a nice little A-gap push. We haven't seen that play very much.
Hadn't seen it all night long.
You're talking about an answer so far.
Right there. Nobody home in the A-gap for Alabama.
I think Phyllis just grabbed the oxygen tank.
Just remember, Sean Payton had an onside kick in the Super Bowl.
Yeah. He did against Indianapolis.
Yeah. I want to say his was the first play of the second half.
Yeah,
I think.
It sure was.
Were you on that team?
No. I'd already
a little different first play of the second half than the fourth quarter.
What a play.
What a play.
What a play by hand. What a play.
That was. Okay, remind you, number one recruit in the country 2 years ago. Third team on third string on the depth chart.
That's what I keep trying to tell all of our recruits.
What a read.
Be three.
It was a tremendous read by him. They were going to zone read him. Just a great athletic play there.
The depth.
Fresh man coming in the fourth quarter, Coach.
Yeah. Now you see a spread formation. Maybe quarterback draw to make it third and manageable.
It's a pressure.
Reuben Foster couldn't get over there.
Still make it
manageable. You got half of them back.
Stick route, yep.
Now second and seven.
Third and five, obviously.
Is it four down territory, Coach, this early? Eight minutes left?
No. I think you're going to take a shot in the end zone here.
And if you don't get it, you kick the field goal?
You're kicking the field
goal.
Find number 13. Number 13, Renfro. He's standing right
in the slot, isn't he?
At the slot. Number two right here, just outside the hash on the bottom.
I think they're going to go to 11.
Inside.
Yep.
Ooh. Yeah, 13 is open, I think.
Yeah. Deshaun Watson took a big hit right there.
Nice little, looks like they ran a little, nice little TE game at the top up there.
Little TE. They never did that with you, Boog.
Oh, man, I could get vertical.
Not explosive enough.
Are you serious?
That's what I heard. That's what Spears told me.
Yeah, exactly, Spears.
All right, here we go. This guy's money inside of 40 yards. This one's a 31-yarder.
Overloading the left guard again.
Hudel delivers.
They answered, but they didn't tie.
Very good answer, though. Everything going wrong, a good job by Clemson getting some points on that one because they get stopped there. Alabama gets a ball, takes it down again. Then you have some serious concerns.
I tell you, Clemson's offense the whole game has done a nice job of responding to potential and Alabama closing the door.
Alabama's had some epic late drives with Derrick Henry.
They have. And you know what, Paul, right now? 7 minutes and 40 seconds left in this game. You got the lead. You got the Heisman Trophy winner in your backfield. Coach, this is not four-minute offense, but it's very close. Put the ball in his hands. And you know what? If they run their offense right, they may not give the ball back to Clemson until about 2 or 3 minutes left.
Against LSU.
This is time to run the clock. You remember that drive against LSU?
Epic.
An 8.5, 9-minute drive? They need something like this right now. They need an offensive line to step up. They need Derrick Henry run the football downhill. Enough of those east-west runs. It's time to go north and south.
How about a 22-play drive?
Michigan State?
Yeah. You remember that
one? Yeah, exactly.
I think what's impressive, though, about this Clemson team, most people would say next year was supposed to be their year.
Yeah.
However, they sit here right now 7 minutes away from potentially overtaking Alabama and maybe winning a national championship. But listen to this. All right, so that across the line of scrimmage, you got freshman, you got a senior in Eric McLean, you got a junior, sophomore, you got sophomore but Nartavis Scott, Garrett Williams, a freshman, Hunter Renfro, a freshman, Wayne Gallman, a sophomore, Deshaun Watson, a sophomore. This is a young football team.
Yeah,
they've answered adversity tonight.
Let's go to Will in Mississippi. Will, good evening. How are you?
Very good. Y'all doing a really great job there, Paul. Absolutely right.
Thank you, Will.
Sean Payton, first on the third quarter of Super Bowl. But that takes large attachments, if you know what I mean, to pull that one off.
That's one of the biggest onside kicks I've ever seen, but not this big.
No, this was huge. But, I mean, two best teams, they're showing it tonight. Both teams going at it very well coached. And
thanks, Will. Really appreciate it. Have a good evening. Chris is in Oklahoma. Chris, go right ahead.
Hey, hello, fellas. I enjoyed a great game. I wanted to have a question to the coach.
Shoot.
Coach, I grew up in Oklahoma, but I got to tell you, man, I live in Northwest Arkansas, and I'm a huge Razorback fan now. I'm not looking for Les Miles crazy, but I am curious. When do you decide when to make big plays like we just saw with Alabama?
It's a great question. Let me interrupt. Let's get the coach to answer that.
Well, and I said it to Paul, and I mean this, but most of the times when coaches call those type of plays, you want to be in the huge percentage of having success. You probably have seen that kick 20 times.
How high does it have to be in your head?
I would say 90-10. I mean, just because at that critical moment, you can't afford the bad side of it. You know, you got to have the utmost confidence in that kicker. He may have been doing it the last 3 years and never done it once in the game until right there. And, again, you expect to have success. This could be trouble.
This could be.
Wow.
He's going to
go.
About special teams?
Kenyon Drake.
He got in.
That's a touchdown. Yeah. Wow. I tell you what, this Alabama team, when it comes to the return game, has been a different group. That's the 10th non-offensive touchdown we've seen from the Tide this year. Last year, Booger, uno.
Yeah.
That's one.
It is just so extraordinary, Coach. And you were right talking about the tension of this game, Booger. I mean, it is amazing to think how it's turned, and why is that happening? Why are we seeing this? How is it happening?
Well, this one's obviously a big play on the special teams. I think you go back, Alabama doesn't win it last year. They were 100 and whatever, 20 in special teams efficiency with the four main units. This year, they're in the top 20, and you're seeing it right here, right in front of you.
What an effort.
Unbelievable execution.
Yeah.
Coach, people like me have been talking about the comparisons between Nick Saban and Bear Bryant. But as a coach in this league, you compete with Nick Saban, but you appreciate him.
Ridiculous.
If this continues, and it certainly looks extraordinarily good, what does this mean?
Well, I think he should retire.
I'll tell you what, man.
Okay, line of the night.
Yep.
Mark that one down.
I think that the part that I sat here and I said to you guys is, and obviously you lived it firsthand, there's never any quit. I mean, there's just, I knew the four-quarter game. That's why there's four quarters. That's why everybody else was looking around asking questions, except for the guys in the maroon and white over there on the sidelines.
I think we need to definitely address the fan and sideline reaction right here. We have the Sky Cam, and nothing sums up college football quite like the reaction that you're about to see on this Alabama sideline. You see Kenyon Drake watch as he's passing Hugel. Look at pandemonium in the background as well. You can see the fans going nuts, the cheerleaders jumping for joy. This guy right here, well done. Not great when it comes to the vert, Coach. What do you give it?
Sub.
Right. There. Watch this guy.
The guy in white?
Yeah. You know, I've seen worse.
Probably a former band member.
I've seen a heck of a lot better, though, too.
I think another thing we're seeing, this because if this game gets out of hand, we won't get the epic, but this is one of the best championship games we have seen.
Yeah,
at least
very, very,
since
very
Young.
Good game. Very, very competitive football game. And you've seen punch, counterpunch. You've seen each team answer. Special teams for Alabama, the onside kick, the kick return by Kenyon Drake. something that was a nuisance or a negative side of the Alabama football team is now a positive this year. Special teams. Let's not forget about Cyrus Jones all year long.
And here's Kenyon Drake, who was injured, and we didn't know if he'd make it back. He got back in the championship game, and look at him now.
Refresh my memory, who the special teams coordinator at Alabama.
Yeah, that is Bobby Williams.
Bobby Williams has been with Coach Saban.
Since Michigan State.
Seated him at Michigan State.
You wonder if was the guy that called the onside kick. One would tell you that, you know, and then dial up the kickoff.
It wasn't long ago, 2 years ago, everyone was questioning and exercising this Alabama special teams.
I tell you what, man, that right there for Kenyon Drake, though, I want to go back to him, and we're taking a peek at him right now. And just,
3 or 4 with the broken arm.
You know, honestly, it makes me emotional just knowing him as a person. Yeah, it's hard to even talk about. Just knowing what he's gone through. With the broken leg last year against Ole Miss, breaking his arm this year, having to overcome some of the hurdles, and making a play like that on the biggest stage in his final game in the Crimson and White. Regardless of who you're cheering for, you have to be happy for a guy that's endured so much pain over the course of his career, trying to finish his career on a high note.
We've seen a block field goal, the kick return, and an onside kick.
Special teams make a difference in close games.
Clemson down by 11. They haven't been down by this all year long. Their season's on the brink.
Yeah.
It's going to be fun. This is what we tune in and watch for.
What's so interesting, too, I mean, what's Alabama's strength and conditioning program? Fourth quarter program.
Yeah, fourth quarter.
They've dominated the fourth quarter to this point.
Here he's coming back.
Design run.
And
he's done.
Like I said, to this point, still a lot of time left.
Yeah.
You know, I just happened to see Kenyon's arm as it flashed across. LT Tenpenny is a young man that came in with his running back crew, I think was a very well-liked a player that hits a tough stretch in life and unfortunately is no longer with us. And you see that in every one of those running backs' hands, and then you take a second string running back and turns it into a difference maker and a kickoff return that could be a legendary. You know he's playing for a higher power.
And LT having the game dedicated to him for not only Kenyon Drake, but Derrick Henry
backs
as well.
Yep.
And notice
nice little play right here.
Well, and notice what you see. Alabama.
They ain't flinching.
Alabama backed off a little bit, Coach.
Yeah.
Playing a little zone coverage. Line them, throw the football underneath, rally and make tackles.
I guarantee Clemson scored 2 touchdowns in less than 6 minutes in this season.
Yeah, I can guarantee that, too.
I can promise you that.
But not against Alabama.
Correct.
Once again, 4-man rush. Tim Williams around the corner. Finally, they get to him. Evans, Tim Williams, fresh. Fast guys coming around the edge.
See all these new clean white shirts?
Yeah, fresh guys. Take a look at Tim Williams at the top of the screen. Nice little chop outside move. Evans beating
Coach
the tight
end. Coach, on the other side, you have Dabo Swinney, who's had a great game until the last 5 minutes.
Yeah, not to be lost.
What's he thinking about? What's he communicating?
He's thinking about the first down. Thinking about moving the chains. Putting the ball in his quarterback's hands and making them plays. Have a guy make a few people miss. Make him run across the field.
This guy's run all the way to.
Good things might happen.
Wow.
To the Grand Canyon on that play.
That was a wonderful
this
play.
This is awesome.
That was a long play.
You don't care who wins. I mean, seriously.
I mean, that was an unbelievable
play.
That
really was.
This is fun.
It is.
You like football, Coach?
Especially when you don't care who wins. You know?
Speak for yourself.
I'm an SEC guy.
Yeah, say Paul.
Paul's been bouncing down over here.
Yeah.
I mean, I resuscitated about 10 minutes ago.
Yeah, talk about the highs and lows.
For the paramedics just left.
Two great guys, man. You cheer for people. And
no, that is the thing about this game.
Jeez,
and all the connections we've talked about. But this is an extraordinary display. Nick Saban over there going, what's happening now?
I don't think he said that. That's the PG version.
Maybe slightly different.
You know, I think Nick is a little ticked because there's 1 missed tackle.
Yeah,
there's 2 missed tackles. There's 3 missed tackles.
Bad angle.
You know, bad angle. The corner right there, 4 missed tackles. There's 4 missed tackles on 1 play. So Nick is like, hey, enough with the lackadaisical laissez-faire attitude.
Just if you go back in history 10 years, with 6:42 left in the Rose Bowl between Texas and
Alabama.
And USC, the Longhorns were down by 12.
And what did we say it would take for Clemson to potentially win this one? A Vince Young type of performance.
Yeah.
And look, I mean, Deshaun Watson is as capable as any to lead a comeback. Bama's got to be on it. You see a little stutter right here. This might be a little stop and go on the outside. Sometimes you see that oftentimes us offensive players, we think a little bit too much about our signals, mm-hmm. even though they're a little bit simple. You say a little stutter. Nice pickup on first down.
Still the soft zone coverage, keeping the football in front of me. Bama just doesn't want to give up a big play. I don't think they mind giving up a score. It's just, they just don't want it to come really, really quick.
I can tell you someone who might mind about giving up a score.
Oh, Nelly.
Oh, man. Oh. Wow. It's good effort right
Keith,
there.
Keith
right.
Jackson Ooh. Has joined the film room.
I'm sorry. I thought I haven't done anything bad yet.
That's Petway's second tipped ball at the line of scrimmage.
Because he's the guy also blocked the field goal.
Yeah, also blocked the field
blocked
goal.
Blocked the field goal.
Having himself a day.
Ooh, what was that close right there?
As a quarterback, you're sitting there and you see the ball go up in the air. You start immediately taking the angle to the closest sideline because oftentimes those are going back the other way.
3rd and 3, coach, down 11. Is this 4 down, or you take the field goal if you don't get it?
No, I think it's 4 down for sure.
Oh, we got it.
Yeah. Forward progress. We'll give it to him at the 15.
Good spot by the side judge.
Yeah.
Right there, another good play call by Jeff Scott and Tony Elliott, the offensive coordinators for Clemson, throwing a little swing route, little screen into the pressure.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty good job rallying up and making the tackle for only a gain of 4.
No, it's the clock, though, guys. The clock is just tick, 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 tick.
2 timeouts left for Clemson, too.
Boy, he's got to walk in. Yeah, that's bad. Bad. They did get leverage there. That's not
okay.
We'll take a look at it.
They're going to go for 2
one onside kick. Oh, yeah. Too early?
No. You're going to go for 2 here. It's 11-point game.
Yep, 2 points for sure.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if Clemson knows it. Yeah, they do.
A lot of people who bet on Alabama are just kick the wall.
One of the things that is just never talked about, it's so hard to convert on 2-point conversions sometimes because you have such emotion having just converted on a touchdown. 2-point is tough at times.
They're going to overload to the right. I bet you're going to get some.
Yeah. I think you're going to get pressure by Alabama and it got
to
have it.
He took away the sprint to the right, that's for sure.
Oh! Oh, he's going to try to beat him to the corner. Oh. Couldn't do it.
They hang time. How was Calvin?
That was a pretty physical collision right there on the sideline.
Five-point game.
It was over, now it's not over.
Well, I mean, Cyrus Jones plays man-to-man coverage there and just gives up the inside. When you don't have safety help, you cannot give up the inside like that, and that's what Cyrus Jones did.
It looked like he knew.
Like he almost expected help, but he didn't have help.
I probably wish they could have this call back here.
How about this right here? Who says that you have to be on the team to show the emotion? Watch my man right here getting into the action a little bit. Not the best circle. I apologize for my accuracy.
Yeah.
Getting into it. Let's go. Let's go.
I wonder who he's cheering for.
He's getting a double fist.
Big Clemson fan, I think. Big Clemson fan.
He's probably getting the sideline pass revoked.
Right,
quickly.
Right now.
If I'm him, I'm hiding.
I'm just glad it wasn't. 2 of my pilots are down there somewhere.
Yeah, that was a soft drive from Alabama's defense.
Yeah,
that's
you could tell. You could tell they were playing soft zone coverage, keeping the ball in front of them, running the clock. Is it time for an onside kick, Coach?
No, I don't think so.
No, too much time, I think, right?
Okay.
Especially with 2 timeouts.
Maybe they try a little
Sky?
Little chip?
Yeah.
What do you think?
Alabama's playing for it. They're just going to kick this baby deep. This will be interesting because the ball might be on the ground depending on where they're stationed.
Would you have given any thought to the onside?
No, but I would have tried to put something in play over there. There's only one returner back there.
Kick it to the wide side over there?
We talked about the epic Henry drive. They didn't need it. Now what?
Now you need it.
Well, I mean,
this is classic.
Now you got to have it.
This is classic vintage. If you're going to have one. You know.
Well, it's 2 things in play here. Alabama wants to run the football. Clemson knows you have to run the football. So now, does Lane Kiffin counter that from the beginning? And maybe if they get the ball toward midfield, go play action.
Right.
Because a touchdown right here basically seals the game. So it's point counterpoint right now. But you definitely think Derrick Henry's going to get the football right now.
Alabama has not rushed the ball very well in this half.
I think you're going to get a little bit of a run to the right-hand side right here.
2 timeouts for Clemson as we take you through the last 4:40 of the game.
There's your run to the right. Dom Jackson just whiffs right there at the line of scrimmage.
I don't think you can call timeout. I think you just manage this. You got him playing behind the chains now.
And look at the right.
Dodd has been having one of the better days I've seen. I mean, he just, my goodness, Jackson.
That's a whiff. I mean, that's.
Dodd's been the most dominant defensive player on the field tonight, maybe on both sides.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Maybe on both sides. He's been the most dominant defender on the field. He's got three sacks, several tackles for loss, and he has been outstanding tonight for Clemson.
He could be the MVP.
Yeah.
Alabama better watch the shot clock right here.
It's
9 seconds left.
Yeah. He's got to call a timeout.
There it is.
Probably fortunate for Jake that the umpire didn't see it until there was only 2 seconds left on the shot clock.
Yeah.
So he tried to call it with six. You want to drain it all the way down. Every second counts at this point. Well, I think second and 13.
I'm thinking screen.
High percentage completion,
yeah.
Screen.
Yeah.
We haven't seen a halfback slow screen yet.
Yeah.
I mean, we haven't really seen them try to get Derrick Henry up and inside. Now, I understand it's a very, very good front. They're mm-hmm. very aware. So it's going to be important for him to sell it if they try to go to it.
Right.
But I think a halfback slow screen to the left-hand side is probably the direction I would go.
Yeah.
So you have the field.
And you get your most athletic lineman in Cam Robinson out in space.
Yes.
Where he can run, you know. Coach, what's your play call here? Second and 13.
It's going to Henry. I don't know if it's a pass or a run or a slow. I think he's just getting a handoff, yeah. Or a little pop pass.
O.J. Howard, over 150 yards receiving. What a night by O.J. Howard.
Unbelievable.
Stay in bounds. Think about it.
It's hard to do.
Yeah,
it doesn't matter. It's 3:15.
I'm glad.
Clock starts anyways.
I'm glad they got O.J. Howard out of witness protection for this game.
Paul, I think that's close to or over 200 yards receiving for O.J. Howard tonight.
Guys, I just real quick, this is not going to take a ridiculous telestration, but watch Jake right here. All right, this is a senior quarterback playing in his final game for the Crimson Tide. Watch him right here on the screen, and look at the duress that he's under. I mean, he's got to throw it off his back foot, get high and over the top against a guy coming in over his head. Nice, soft, good touch on the football, and hitting him in stride accurately. That's a really good throw. Even though it's only 7 yards away, you can't take for granted how good a throw that was.
An excellent call, excellent play.
Also, it's a safe play.
But I'm going to tell you, number two is in that ballgame.
You're absolutely right.
It's a missed tackle by his backup.
You're absolutely right.
I mean, it affects everybody. You're in a national championship game, and you got a missed tackle there. It's going to be third down.
Yeah.
It's going to be third and seven, third and eight.
Yeah.
And the difference is they're on the other plus side. Depth and seeing your best players make plays is usually the winner.
So clock management here for Clemson, Coach.
Take as much possible time, get as many points as you possibly can have.
But Clemson, though, on their side, conversely, when do you start to burn them?
You know, there's a great little NFL study, anything that plays ahead of the chain. So if they're second and six or less, like here, don't take it because the chances of them getting a first down already in their favor.
Right.
If it was second and six or more, you might take it. But now the chances of them getting it are too strong.
Now the other question I have for you that's probably even more important. If Derrick Henry scores, do you flash the Heisman?
I would.
I would in a heartbeat.
I'd flash it.
I think universally the officials, we even had some situations in our game. In the bowl games, they let them play a little bit.
Right, you should, don't you think?
As long as it isn't an extended, celebration, let's have some fun. We don't get to play football for another year.
If I'm Jacob, letting it drain right here,
you've
got 4
Chinese?
Seconds. It's not perfect. Call timeout at 1 second left.
Oh, my. That wasn't planned. I can't tell you.
That's okay, though. And
you think
Jake's
that demonstration
upset?
Right there is planned? That was called confusion.
Can we toss it to Jake's mic right now so we can hear what he just said?
Jake is hot right now.
He is heated. I know that feeling. Oh, my goodness.
Well, he probably thought he had a play. And, you know, O.J. Howard was lined up on one side. Jake thought he should have been on the other side. A little miscommunication there.
Did you see that? I just cut a reception for over 200 yards. Did you see that? I can line up where I want to line up.
I wonder when the last time an Alabama tight end has been over 200 yards.
Ozzie Newsome?
Yeah, I mean, he's got five catches for over 200 yards tonight.
Yeah, he's been phenomenal. And run after catch, too.
Correct.
A couple wide open, one busted defense for
yes,
sure.
Yes.
He's made some plays. I want to definitely keep a camera on Lane Kiffin right here. The emotion that he's going to show, perhaps if they get a first down, and you would have to assume it's going to be.
He will jump up in the air.
There. Be smart.
Oh, my.
First and 10.
There you go, first and 10.
Jake redeems himself.
Yeah.
Lane a little too under control for my liking.
O.J. Gronk, maybe his new nickname. Well, listen to Eli Gold of the Alabama Radio Network. Actually, we may wait a minute because Dabo is.
Did he call a timeout?
Right there. I think he burned one, it looks like.
Yeah, we'll have to play. You actually, you're at 210. I don't have my sheet in front of me. What, with two timeouts, with outside runs, you'd be able to run the clock out, so he knows that.
What a good job right here, Jake. Using his athleticism, this is the difference for him.
And as good a game as Dodd has played, 98, pulls him up, but he can't make that tackle right there. Jake uses his athleticism, as you said, Greg, gets the first down.
What a good job making the play caller right.
Yeah.
You know?
Mm-hmm.
Coaches can't call a perfect game.
Yeah.
Right there, well defended.
It was.
Players make plays, though. Jay Coker, last two games, hats off to him, man.
Well, and think about this game. I mean, early on, we kept asking the question, man, what's wrong with Jay? I mean, the first probably two and a half quarters, I mean, Jay Coker did not look good. He was very unsettled, but he just kept playing, kept throwing, and the throw to our Darius Stewart, okay, a little cover seven beater down the right sideline, mm-hmm. kind of got him going. And ever since then,
it took a while, but Lane Kiffin has had a really nice half.
Yes. And look.
Here we go again.
Look at the large boys in the game.
Big boys. Robinson and Reed. Guess where they're going?
They had big wide A gaps again.
He didn't cross. They're going to have to snap it again.
If they got that.
Let's listen to Eli Gold of the Crimson Tide Radio Network.
Or they're going to let it run out here.
Play clock at 27. Game clock at a minute 54. Alabama. Here comes Nicewander. Here comes Hale Hentges. That will allow Jaron Reed and Ashawn Robinson to leave.
Yeah, they gave him one shot
play
at it.
Play clock at 9, 8, 7, 6, 5. Coker under center. Follows Ryan Kelly. Lunges forward. Does he get there?
This is even better for Alabama.
He does not get
because
there.
Because that clock continues to run, and they'll have to use their timeouts here.
Timeout Clemson.
There you go.
The third and final of the game.
So both teams are out of timeouts. Coker, I mean, folks, you can't get the nose of that football any closer to the white line. With a minute 21 to go, Alabama leading 38-33. I'm trying to add a touchdown here.
Please correct the game clock to read 122.
They're putting
122 on the game clock.
They're putting 1 second back on the clock to make it 122. That adjustment has been made.
So there we are, final moments of the game. What happened there? Did he get over?
It was a big foul. I don't think he did, but they burned a lot of time.
You have to have indisputable video evidence. It doesn't look like there's anything there that tells me that ball crossed the plane.
All right.
That line
judge. At this point, Alabama's just happy to have another play.
Yeah, absolutely.
Now, I don't think that's necessarily a bad thing.
No.
You know, I think you got to put a touchdown in here, though. You got to score. I'm going to say Derrick Henry right.
Yeah.
Well, then.
Something Derrick Henry. Or does Lane Kiffin say, you know what, why even turn around and hand it off? Let's go quarterback sneak again.
Or two of them.
Yeah, exactly, Coach. I don't know if he got in. Wow. Wow.
No way to stop the clock.
Now what do you do? Do you kick it and go up?
You're going to give it to him. They just raised their hands.
They did?
That is a touchdown.
Phenomenal.
Safe to assume this is going to be reviewed. Oh,
yeah,
wait, hang on a second. We might need to take a peek of what we just saw.
A little bit of activity there, wasn't it?
On the second effort, rolling. That's a touchdown.
That ball crossed the plane. All it has to do is hit the white.
Touch the glass.
Yeah, I think by that view.
A lot of the people who took Alabama minus seven are watching this closely.
And that right there, that's a touchdown.
Yeah.
And I want to make sure that we cue up this ISO cam a little bit because we might have had our first correct prediction of the night. I saw a very humble Heisman.
You saw a little humble Heisman?
He
definitely got
Heisman.
In, didn't he?
Yeah, I got in. I could see why Clemson's complaining, but he got in.
They're saying that his forward progress was stopped.
How could they not give it
right
to
there,
him?
Right there. Well, if they're saying his forward progress is stopped, then it doesn't matter what happens after they say it.
By the way, I love
what the ruling on the field is a touchdown. It'll stand.
It'll stand.
Yeah.
Pac-12 officials have made themselves very popular today. On both sides.
Yeah.
But I think Dabo will maybe be chasing them down when it's all over. I know you would be.
I'd handle it very well.
Touchdown.
Yeah.
Alabama is going to win their 16th national championship.
An incredible afternoon into early evening into late night here, Coach Bielema. You were the smart guy in the group. I'll speak for myself. There was one guy panicking over here. You calmed us down, but it's over now. Alabama is going to do it, and Nick Saban, by many, will be considered the best coach of all time.
Well, and you got to look at the adversity. There was a couple of points tonight where Clemson had this team on the ropes. And I think that, you know, by all accounts, Nick Saban, his team is mentally tough. Coach Bielema, you talked about it. There was
100%.
No panic.
Nope.
They line up. They stick to the process. They stick to the plan. And just the mental fortitude that they showed tonight, bouncing back. Derrick Henry, the Heisman Trophy winner. O.J. Howard. We often question where he is, over 200 yards receiving tonight. Jake Coker, not a very, very good first half, comes back in the second half, makes the throw to our Ardarius Stewart. It just shows you the resiliency of this team is patterned after their head coach. They don't panic, they line up, and they just execute. And you got to give hats off to them for that.
Again, go to the unbelievable call, the onside kick.
Yeah.
It's a game, you know, and took everybody a minute to get through that whole situation. But, again, it's one thing for you as a coach to come over and say, hey, calm down, everybody calm down. But then they did it.
Yeah.
You know, coaches can say a lot of the right things, but when you actually perform it.
Let's get some quick reaction from Alabama. Jerome, good evening.
What's going on, Paul? Paul, you ain't got enough time in the day for me to say what I got to say. But all I'm going to say, bye-bye, we shook up the world, baby. We shook up the world. Roll damn time. Roll damn time.
Thank you, Jerome.
Oh, gosh.
Enjoy the night. Thanks. They will be.
What a performance, man.
Both sides.
And Clemson has nothing to hold their heads up.
They played great.
They played a very, very good football team.
Like you said, a young team, got a lot to build on.
Yep.
Yeah, definitely. And you know, for Clemson and Dabo Swinney, you knew that this was a young team. Deshaun Watson, he made us think about Vince Young tonight. He made us think back to the Rose Bowl with the type of performance he was putting on early on. He just didn't have enough help at the end. And I think that defensively, they battled. Key interception, Eddie Jackson made the key pick. A couple of key plays in this game, the interception by Jackson. And the onside kick. I think those were two key plays. And obviously the Kenyon Drake touchdown return, Coach.
Tell you what, something else that's probably going to be completely underlooked here is how much of the CFP committee put two great teams in this
game. And got it right,
man, did they?
I mean, you can argue about the four, but these two right here, man.
There is no doubt.
I mean,
that
put
the two
on
best
one for
teams
the ages,
in the country.
It's
with all due respect to some of the Ohio State fans and the Michigan State fans, Stanford, these are the two best teams in the country, and they slugged it out tonight, man.
And continue to do so.
Yeah.
No quitting these dogs. You talk about the unsung. Who would have thought of O.J. Howard? You talk about all these different names, and then out of nowhere, and I give Lane a lot of credit for designing those plays, making them happen. Obviously, to make the throws and the catch, pretty incredible.
I remember being in the situation and just so hoping that we would end the game on offense because I wanted to take a knee and I wanted to keep the ball.
Right.
So
it's so selfish.
It's so selfish.
That's so quarterback.
Spoken like a quarterback, though.
It is selfish, but I really want it.
Right, I understand.
I think that's fair, right?
Yeah, it is. You're getting kind of emotional over here next day. Are you okay?
I just, national championships are just so hard to win, man. And they're just, you only have such a finite period of time to do it.
Saban's still coaching hard.
Unbelievable.
Because it's about the process, Paul. That's what it's about. And you know what? I just hope they don't hit him upside the head with the Gatorade jug tonight the way they did. I didn't pass the data.
And he'll get angry.
He was ticked.
It's still a little too soon. I remember that one for sure.
Tell you what, defensively too, I mean, I know it's a 45-33 game, but if you lose your coordinator and your DB coach, they're going in different directions to get the kids to play the way they are and to hold it together during the course of the game is pretty awesome.
Here they come. They're getting ready for it.
I throw a little bit more ice in there.
The onside kick, coach.
Huge.
The game was won by coaching. I mean, that's
amazing.
You know, the players did a great job, but it came down to decisions by Nick Saban and Bobby Williams and the offensive staff, the defensive staff. I mean, it was coaches that won this game.
Alabama's best players want to get on the field so bad they don't want them to score. You're going to see an onside kick, ladies and gentlemen.
We'll see one more. I think
this one will be probably defended a little differently.
Yeah.
That touchdown has pushed this.
Yeah. What was the line that you were talking about?
The line was 7.
Wow.
That just beat the.
So we get it to a.
One thing that touchdown did, though, historically. It made that turned this into one of the greatest games ever. It was already one.
Yeah.
The score helps when it's this close.
Missing a left wing.
This was. I mean, this was an outstanding football game.
Yeah, 19 seconds on the play clock. You're good. Don't hurry. Get 11.
Deshaun Watson still
the first thing Saban will say after the game. I don't know why we gave up that last touchdown.
Well, look, this isn't over yet.
This is your hands, team. This is what you practice every week. Now you're going to be able to do it.
Yeah, I mean, this is not over. I mean, we said that Alabama's going to win it, but I'll tell you what, I've seen crazy things happen in regards to Hail Marys this year. That's the Detroit Lions.
How much time will they have left, Coach?
There's 12 seconds, so outside kick will probably be less than five to six. Depends how long it gets battled around. If there's not a scrum, this goes back into even think about the play where they sneaked the quarterback. He didn't get in.
All right.
But Dabble wanted to wait and hold that timeout.
Yeah.
They burn about 8 seconds right there. How bad would they love to have 8 seconds right now?
Yeah.
No doubt. And Deshaun Watson's got a big arm.
Conversion?
I mean, if they.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
If they do recover the onside kick, Deshaun Watson has a huge arm. He can throw it 65 yards easily in the air.
I would guess somewhere around 5 to 7.
This is going to be about execution, too. Special teams plays.
You know, there's probably a good chance Clemson has not shown an onside kick all year.
They haven't.
Yeah.
Because they haven't trailed.
So now you go back to year two, year three. I mean, this is classic all the time as coaches. Sometimes you end up going back 3 or 4 years. You'll follow a coach to another school just to find out what they'll do on onside. This is pretty traditional, actually. Well, they got a chance.
Push it out of bounds.
It's out of bounds.
That's it. Victory. Greatest formation.
Oh,
football.
Yep. Greg's got his ball.
Yep. Jake Coker gets his ball.
He deserves his ball, man.
What a great story for a kid that went through a lot, man.
Pretty good kick. Had a chance at it. Just got the big hop a little bit too
late. Look who's out on the field. Henry.
Yeah.
Out on the field. One of 17 million assistants.
Take the headset off.
What's that, man?
Wow. Emotional for Reggie Bragg.
You like that bath when you win a big game?
I feel pretty good. I feel pretty good. He's not overly happy, but.
Jake's saying, we need green personnel on the field.
Yeah.
Two tight ends, two running backs, and the receiver.
Got him.
Oh.
Red Gatorade. They got it with the red.
That's it.
That's so awesome.
Wow.
What an amazing game.
SEC.
Great game.
Fifth national
champion. Get him up. Get him up.
Really bad habit. Can you hang on the ball?
Yeah.
Well, he's your quarterback, isn't he?
Well, Paul, I talked to you earlier on your show. This is his fifth national championship. Fourth at Alabama. He's got one at LSU. We can talk about, and Coach, I'd love to hear your thought. We can talk about Urban Meyer. We can talk about Bobby Bowden and the late Joe Paterno. In this era, now, with a scholarship limit, how can Nick Saban not be the greatest coach in the history of college football?
Well, during my time, obviously, I don't think anybody can even argue anything right now. Especially the fact you got into two different schools. I think that speaks volumes as well. But it's pretty special to watch. And as a competitor in the league, as a guy that competes against them all the time, it's not surprising. They got great players. They're very well coached, and they have a lot of faith.
Greg, you were in this position in January 2010. You have to go out to the field. We'll join you in a few minutes. But your final thoughts on your coach and your school winning another national championship?
Well, I'm just so proud of them. You know, I mean, look, we're unbiased when it comes to our job, and we're grateful to have the job that we do, but you always have a real sense of pride when you see your team and the guys you know and the coach you appreciate and you love, when you see them cashing in on what has been an incredible opportunity. And this game was won by Nick Saban. I mean, with his call on the onside kick, the surprise onside, the adjustments made in the second half and the fourth quarter, I just couldn't be more excited for Alabama fans to be able to appreciate this, because this is so difficult to do. Only the second time in history that a team's won four national championships in a seven-year span. I never say it, but you got to say Roll Tide in this particular case. It's a fitting ending.
Greg, thank you so much. We'll see you out in the field in a little while. You got to get moving.
And get a tissue, because you're going to start crying.
It's hard to do it. It's hard to do it.
I know, man.
What's so incredible is how many people in the media wrote this dynasty off last year, Coach. And I'll give you credit. Watching Alabama, you're neutral. When you're involved in it, they're tough to watch sometimes, because you expect them to be perfect, and you know that can't happen. And they were pretty close to perfect in that fourth quarter.
They're human in correctable ways, you know. They're going to make a mistake, but yet they can be corrected. And, again, their faith is unprecedented. They got a lot of really good players, too.
Yeah. And you know what? You get really good players, Coach. You coach them up. You put a system in place that everybody believes in. And the trust that the players have in Nick.
100%.
That when Nick says don't panic, they don't panic. Because they've been there and done that. And to me, the ability to get his young men not only to play, but to listen to him in crucial situations, that says a lot about the relationship that he has with his players.
And they have a little staff transition.
Well, you talk about
even more.
Frank Leahy, John McKay, Nick Saban, Bear Bryant, all with more than four. Saban, one behind Bryant, at the same school. Four of those at the same school. Jake.
And then, you know, also, Paul, for Jay Coker. Think about this. He transferred from Florida State, came to Alabama, got beat out by Blake Sims. Now he's the national championship winning quarterback at Alabama. How many times do you see a guy transfer, then win a national championship? Yeah. So hats off to Jay Coker.
Two years ago, he was on the field in Pasadena.
In my opinion, might be, from what I've witnessed, and I haven't been able to watch Clemson as much as I saw Alabama, he might be the most improved football player in 1 year that I've seen in a long time. At that kind of level, you know, you see a guy get a lot better. But from game one, two, and three, lost to Ole Miss to where he is right now, he won the game there down the stretch by making great decisions, but his coaches put him in good decisions.
We're not done yet. We'll be here until the trophy presentation, then we'll turn it back to the field with the guys out there, and then head over there ourselves. Take a short break. Alabama has done it again.
Welcome back to Feinbaum Film Room, presented by AT&T.
Yeah, we welcome you back. We're on the film room beginning to wind things down as Alabama has claimed another national championship with Coach Bielema. And Booger, will add your phone calls here in a moment at 855-242-7285. It's almost midnight in Alabama, but I don't think too many people have gone to bed yet.
You think Phyllis is still up?
I'm sure we'll hear from her soon.
Yeah, you gotta get your mic back on there, Paul.
I keep trying to leap so quickly to get out in the field and rolling the confetti. It keeps falling off.
Snow angels tonight again?
I think so, yeah.
I tell you, whoever got next to Coker during halftime and calmed him down, whether it was Nick, whether it was Lane, whether it was teammates, whether it was himself, that to me was the difference in the game. Just pulled himself together, came back and played a pretty good second half.
A lot of happy people. It's tough, but it always is. Clemson, I think, we knew they were good, Booger, better than good.
Well, not only are they better than good, but we knew this quarterback was good, and he put on a show tonight.
He really did.
I mean, final numbers, I think he's close to 500 yards of offense himself. Just by himself. And you talk about all the young guys they have coming back offensively. Clemson is a young football team. Paul, I want to ask you this because you're a historian of the game, and you and I have often had this conversation. You remember Bear Bryant. You see where Nick Saban is right now. You've seen Urban Meyer. You've seen them all, Joe Paterno, Bobby Bowden. Where do you rank Nick Saban at right now?
I rank him better than Bryant. And I say that, and I can't even believe I'm saying it. And Coach, I covered Coach Bryant's last 2 years. And, I mean, I cried like everyone when I sat in the audience at his retirement on December 15th, 1982. And I thought it was over. I thought my career had peaked in my early 20s, that I would never see anything like this. I have, and the only bad thing is you have to coach against it.
But that's fun. I mean, that's why I came to the SEC.
Sure.
It was the best of the best, and I think that's because of this guy right here. I think he stands for a lot more than just, you know, a couple of trophies. I think you look at the type of players he puts out, the type of players that go on to have success in the league. I think today's recruiting is so difficult, yet they've been able to be the gold standard, you know, and have good recruiting classes year after year and not let it get to their head. Because we see some teams, they'll have the number one ranked recruiting class 3 years later, the coach is fired because they can't keep them together. Yeah. But he obviously knows how to handle the
situation.
Nick
Saban, his wife Terry, who has stood with him, and a lot of people believe because of her, Saban wouldn't entertain a thought to even leave. But Bill Hancock there, it's an amazing scene. We've seen a lot of these, Booger.
Well, I mean, you've definitely seen a lot of scenes like this, and you got to give your hats off. And, you know, Paul, here's a lesson. You know, for young people out there across the country watching this game tonight, let's take a look at two people. We talked about Jay Coker. He went to Florida State. He transferred. What about Kenyon Drake? You talk about guys that have persevered, that have been through a lot. The guy breaks his leg last year. All he does is come back. He breaks his arm. He comes back. And when you talk about a key play in the game, a momentum-changing play, look what he did. And it's amazing if you keep believing in the system, you keep believing in the coaches like Coker, like a guy like Kenyon Drake. It's amazing what the outcome in life. Football, Paul, is the greatest teacher in life. Yeah. I think it's the greatest teacher of people and things in life. And it's amazing what these young people are learning at Alabama. And as much as we talk about Nick being as great as Bear Bryant, I think when you look at Nick, what he is as a person and how he's raising young men at Alabama, I think people around the country, even if you hate the SEC, even if you hate the Southeastern Conference, you can take solace in the fact that he's training young men to be men, Brett.
I would agree.
I don't know if I've seen Nick wear a shirt like that before.
I was kind of surprised he slid that over there.
Well, that is a man who's starting to figure it all out.
He smiled during an onside, and I might even crack a joke with him at the spring SEC meeting. Just see how loose he's getting.
Just an incredible scene right there. Bill Hancock smiling. The ratings for this will be great. He won't be maligned anymore.
After that New Year's Eve thing?
John Saunders on the field.
To the Clemson Tigers on a tremendous season and a very hard-fought game. But time to do it once again, Bill. Joining me is Bill Hancock, the executive director of the college football playoff, to hand out the championship trophy.
John, is college football awesome or what? On behalf of the conferences and schools that manage the college football playoff, I do want to congratulate both of these teams for a great effort tonight and all during this most compelling regular season. And now it's my pleasure and honor to present the national championship trophy to Coach Nick Saban and the Alabama Crimson Tide.
Nick, congratulations on your fifth. We'll talk about that in a moment. But first, what do you have to say to the faithful of the Crimson Tide who've waited for this again?
Well, you know, this is all about this team and the players on this team. There weren't very many people early in the season that thought this team could do it. And this team made a tremendous commitment to one another and did it together. And I've never been prouder of a group of young guys than I am. And that's why I'm so happy for these players.
It's interesting because after the loss to Ole Miss, and you guys turned the ball over a bunch in that game, you might have won that one. But after the loss, what did you have to say to the group to get them to make a charge like this?
How do you respond to a loss? You know, you got to have character to overcome adversity, and everybody's going to have to buy in and do things exactly like we need to do them to be a better team. And every one of these guys did it, and that's why we're here now.
It took a little something extra. I was standing on the sidelines with Urban Meyer, and he talked about what is your commitment to win. What's the commitment of this group of guys?
Well, they have tremendous passion for each other, for the game, and we've got a lot of great competitors on this team, and the leadership on this team has been fabulous. So I've never been prouder of a bunch of guys. I mean, they've just overcome so much to get here. We didn't play our best game tonight, but they did what they had to do to win, and I'm smiling.
What does it say about a team that's as dominant as you guys are on defense, that has an offense with a running back like Derrick Henry that can explode like that, and special teams may have been the difference?
I think special teams may have been the difference in this game. The onside kick and the kickoff return for a touchdown sort of changed the momentum of the game. And, you know, but we made some big explosive plays on offense. We got them stopped a few times when we needed to on defense. So it's a great team win, and I'm proud of all of them.
I had a chance to chat with your better half, Terry, when she took the podium here, and she said, boy, it's more fun like this in a close game. Do you feel the same way as you walk off with your fifth championship?
No, I think I aged a little bit tonight. But, you know, what I want to say to all of our fans and all of our players, which I said at our banquet this year, is I thank them for all that they've done to make this team what they could be. But I say there's an IOU that goes with every thank you, and I owe them so much for their great effort in terms of what they did. And we owe them our best. We try to give them our best as coaches, and they responded like champions that they are. So we're excited for them.
As you ask you one final question, and that would be, as I mentioned, five championships, four at Alabama, and try to pick one that is better. Is it all about what the team has given you when you try to decide what separates this from the other four?
Well, you know, look, this is all about these players on this team, and none of those other championships really were anything that I ever thought about other than what can we do to help this team be successful. And I'm so pleased and proud of it. I haven't even thought about the rest of it. So I'm just happy for this bunch of guys to do what they did tonight against Clemson.
Nick, congratulations again.
Thank you,
congratulations to the entire team. Congratulations to the Alabama Crimson Tide. I guess the Bears up next, Chris.
Saving one short.
As you see Nick Saban accepting the College Football Playoff Championship trophy, what a fun night. What a fun night. Paul Feinbaum and Greg are gone. Coach Bielema and I will be back to wrap it up.
Feinbaum Film Room is presented by AT&T. Mobilizing your world.
Coach, as we come back here wrapping this up, Greg and Paul are headed out on the field for the postgame show. What did you see tonight, and how did you think Alabama got it done?
Well, I saw more of the same. I saw two really good football teams that had done a lot of really good things. And good to see Alabama pull it out, but can't take anything away from Clemson and what they did this year as well.
Yeah, I thought it was an outstanding performance, Coach. Film Room, great job tonight. Really, really appreciate
you
being here.
Appreciate it.
Alabama, Nick Saban. Nick wins his fifth national championship, his fourth national title at Alabama. He's got one at LSU. Does he go down as the greatest coach of all time? I think so. For Brett Bielema, Booger McFarland, Paul Feinbaum, Greg McElroy on the field, SEC Now postgame college football playoff special starts now.